this prestigious foundation, which is the Theocharakis Foundation. And I would like to thank especially the director, Mr. Fotis Papathanasiou, for his help and for his assistance in organizing this beautiful event. But mainly, I would like to thank Stavri Nikolov. He is the soul, the beginning and the end of this the end when I mean in the, for the whole project, which lasts, etc. It's not only for today. For the where sustain Southeastern Europe. I'm very happy as president of the Heritage Museum to welcome you and to thank as well the other two colleagues, Tassos Politis and Takis Lybereas, who will be the co-organizers of this event, and I hope for the future events that are going to take place in Athens. I will give you some few points on heritage and museums, which I have the honor to be president. Well, it is a not-for-profit organization, which has its founding here in Athens. And I will give you some highlights of what we are doing. It is a foundation, an institution that has 10 years of age in 2018. So, Heritage and Museums is a non-for-profit organization based in Athens, Greece, aiming at the promotion of international cultural heritage through the coordination and implementation of communication, education, and research activities. Works of Heritage and Museums are based on collaboration and volunteerism, with a special interest in people with special needs, citizens with limited access to cultural products, and the environment. H&M is in partnership with the EMF, the European Museum Forum, which is a Council of Europe foundation, and with which we are, H&M is in a partnership for the last 7 years, and a little while we have before we have re-signed a memorandum of understanding extending it. So we do have also close collaboration with the ministries of education, culture, and also with the Ministry of Development. Now, Heritage and Museums and partners specialize in the coordination and implementation of exposure activities for museums and cultural institutions, such as workshops, exhibitions, and prestigious publications. Moreover, Heritage and Museums intermediates for the development of relations between cultural institutions in different cities and countries. The company has active presence in education through the organization of seminars and workshops for students and adults in fields related to cultural heritage, such as traditional jewelry. So actually, even today, it's the opening of a very big exhibition at the Art and Design Museum in New York concerning Greek jewelry, and two of my students are participating, so I'm very pleased on that. And also about the Ministry of Education, that we are in very close relationship. We have, Heritage Museums has organized a biennale of a pupil competition in art competition, which has proved very successful for all schools of Attica. And the winner of the theme, Painting Europe, is receiving an award. The young person, the teenager, with one of his parents, usually the mother. And I take them for a four-day trip, educational trip, to the museum that that very year had received by the Council of Europe and by EMF, by the European Museum Forum, the Oscar of the best museum of the year, the European Museum. So this is also something that Heritage and Museums has initiated, has thought about it, and is actually working on it, with the support of the Ministry of Education. Nevertheless, having a lot of experience in knowledge management, we provide consulting and project management services to museums and cultural institutions, aiming at the digitization of their collections, the implementation of e-learning programs, the participation in research and development initiatives, and the migration to the new internet. The example is the digitization of the Natural History Museum of Zakynthos, the Helmis Museum, that we offered, and it has been, all the collections have been digitized, and that was the first museum that has its collection digitized in Greece, and by now I hope that there are others as well. So, for that, we have been invited by the Ministry of Development to have a booth in order to present all new technologies in Greek museums, national and private. So that was really a very big achievement for us to have a booth at the Thessaloniki Fair. It's very important. Now, we believe in equal opportunities for all. We encourage the participation of citizens who are willing to offer to the society and make the difference. We are also planning to implement networking services for professionals in the fields of cultural heritage preservation and management. And now the new field that I feel so amazed, and I like the idea so much, and I thank from my heart Stavri Nikolov for that, is to show me the way to where sustain. And so I must say that he has close to him a very good collaborator. Thank you so much.
So my name is Takis Lybereas. I'm working for the Hellenic Clothing Industry Association, one of the partners in this, with the organization of this event. And of course, the main objective of this meeting is not to tell you about what we are doing, but it's about where to stay. But taking this opportunity, I want to show you some projects that we are involved in. And one of them is creative wear, that there is a banner over there. But I will talk about our current activities to see that we are actively involved in the field of new designers and the clothing sector and the fashion. So basically, I'm going to talk about two projects that we're involved in. One is TCBL, that stands for Textile Clothing Business Labs. It's a Horizon 2020 project funded by the European Union. It's a four-year project, and now we're in the middle. For us, it's something very important, because the main objective of Horizon 2020 and of TCBL is actually to transform or to identify different ways of being active in the fashion field. We are trying to get away from the mass market, mass customization, and the Zara's, H&M's, Primark of this world. We're trying to find new sustainable, ethical, new ideas of how to develop and promote the sustainably the fashion sector, not only in Greece, but all around Europe. The main work of TCBL is twofold. One is to develop specific labs. Here in Greece we have three labs. Two are run by the association that I represent, one by Evetam. Evetam is the technical institute for clothing and for fibers. And I'm going to briefly present what the design lab is doing, because this is the actual partner here. And the place lab, these are the two labs that the association is running. The design lab offers services to designers. Offer services to some of you. I think most of you are probably from design schools. We have a library, we have some facilities for training on CAD systems, helping you, helping young designers to design their products, and then helping them to actually develop some small prototype lines. The Place Lab, on the other hand side, is something that we're opening to the world, we're opening to more social aspects of the fashion sector. There's a lot of discussion about ethical manufacturing, about sustainability, about environmental issues. We work a lot with SOFA. SOFA is also making a presentation here. We are actively participating in Fashion Revolution. It's also this weekend is an event in Kipsey, in the market of Kipsey. And this is what we're trying to expand our horizon, not only the manufacturing, but also in more social areas. Within TCBL, there's also a Make Lab. Make Lab is a lab that is operated by Evetam. This is a more technical lab. Evetam is the technical, the clothing and technical organization for fibers and clothes. And they do, they can run tests on chemicals, on the technical aspects of fibers, and issues like that. So if you put the whole chain together from designers to actually testing the products and to the going out to the community, we're trying to cover all this area of how we view the new designs and the new fashion sector evolving. Now, apart from the labs, we are actually involved in 6 business cases. These are cases not only from Greece, but partners from all over Europe. They are involved in these different cases. The first one, the natural cotton, is led by Greeks. It's 90% covered by Greek organizations. We are trying to view the whole value chain from the production in the fields to the final product, to the actual distribution of the final product. And we're looking for very specific areas like sustainable cotton, organic cotton, things that actually exist or do not exist. There is a lot of debate on that. On Monday, this Monday, coming Monday, there is also, we're organizing an event at Zapion with Athens Chamber of Commerce and Industry, specifically focused on sustainable cotton. So if you want, you can join us there. The other 5 cases are short runs led by Italians, I think. No, Italians. Bioshades, it's a much more technical issue run by the VAG Society in Amsterdam. Eco-friendly production, again by Italians. Digital Heritage is the museum of Prato, is one of the best museums in textiles that is running this project. And Independence is for independent designers. We're trying to offer services in all these areas. So this is an ongoing project. Of course, we are not going to stay only these 6. We're trying to identify new business cases, new business models, and trying to play a major role in the involvement of the sector. This is TCBL, something that is perhaps closer to some of you that are in the design sector is the Creative Wear project. This is an HELGRAMED. This is what I have discussed until now is offering service to the clothing sector and designers. Now we're opening the world to not only designers, fashion designers, but to the artists, to the art world. So basically, these are some things that we have already done. One was a batik dyeing on silk workshop done in, during the Technopolis event that we had for this year. Another workshop that was done during the Athens Fashion Trade Show in September. And this is the major thing I want to talk to you about, is the Creative Work Competition. This is a competition that upstairs there was some glossy also. It's for artists and designers and designers to present ideas about fashion. This is, we did not want to establish a very specific thing, we wanted to open it up to the art world. We want to find the synergy between art and fashion. That's why we're cooperating and working together with Athens, the fine arts, the School of Fine Arts in Athens. Not only the usual, let's say, organization involved in the fashion sector, but in the School of Fine Arts in Athens. Now, the competition is on until next Friday, 24th. I'm going to just demonstrate some ideas that have come up, started from designers. See, this is a lady that Despina is involved in the production of clothes, but very specific clothes, very clothes. She's involved there. This is another designer that is much more traditional, let's say, approach. Some other ideas from people from the art sector, for example, have some ideas of creating clothes from paper. So it's a very open contest. The contest, this is just showing some ideas. So basically what we're trying to do is open, as I said, bring together the art world, the cultural world, and the fashion world. This competition, we will receive all the ideas by the 24th of November. In the beginning of December, we have 2 days event in the School of Fine Arts. And there it's very important because these students or these artists can demonstrate their ideas. And from those, we will choose some that will go on to develop prototypes together with the clothing sector and the clothing industry. The main idea is actually to go to the end of next year and have a major event, again at the School of Fine Arts, but this will be an international event with actually people that have made a big difference in this art and fashion collaboration. A person, a guy like Kokkinidis, I'm not sure if you know him, who was a major artist doing a lot of, Greek artists doing a lot of production in the 50s and 60s on clothing. And of course, the new presenters, the new artists that will have all the ideas to get involved there. So this is an open process. The project is still going on. We are open to other artists like photographers, writers, poets, theater actors, anything that you can imagine. Always, we're trying to find a collaboration with the fashion sector. The next steps is, this is one of the events. Here we are because we are a hub for West Sistein, so we are working with Stavri and the other hubs to help designers come together with more technical people to develop whatever Stavri will tell you, talk to you about later. This is the plan for the event in the School of Fine Arts. As I said, 24th of November is the deadline. Next week, 1 week after that, is the presentation workshop in Athens. Then the development of prototypes, and the autumn is the major event in Athens. So, coming back to where she stayed, and the collaboration proposal now that we have here is we have three partners, as Lila mentioned. And the three Greek partners here would like to help you and can help you and to create and to generate cooperations and to develop proposals for the call that Stavri will announce later. So that's why we are here. If you have any questions, I think there's a question part at the end of all the presentations. So if you want something else, you can also contact me anytime you want. You can also find us on the Facebook site, TCD Design Lab, Textile Clothing Design Lab. Thank you very much.
Myself also. Maybe you are quite keen about how these people are cooperating together, since we are originating from quite different sectors and areas. I'm an engineer, and I'm trying to contribute to this project from this part, from this side. However, it is a trend nowadays that people from different areas, like artists, designers, engineers, technologists, people from informatics are coming together for joint projects or joint works in order to do something new. And this is a trend that we discussed with Stavri and Lila and Takis, and we decided to work together as a quick hub from this call. And so, you are here because you are interested in this, and it's a quite interesting approach that we can operate with you. And with a team of Stavri that creates this, runs this project. So I'm coming from the Hellenic Union of Graphic Arts Engineers, graduate from the graphic, from the Department of Graphic Arts Technology from Athens TEI, and we are doing a lot. These are some places where I work and I cooperate. We are those that I said. We are working together with the students, with the graduates, with the researchers, and the entire industry in Greece and abroad. We have a lot of connections and projects running with people from all over Europe and the USA. What we do, we create, we develop projects on this specific area of ours, namely printing, finishing, creating printed and electronic matters and products, and we are looking forward in developing this sector, which is running quite enormously nowadays. We have to do a lot with textile and fashion, because we print what is wearable. We can print something that can be interactive and can react with an interface or with a device like a mobile phone or something like that. And from this point of view, we are quite interested in the area of textile and clothing, as well as we do a lot with packaging area, which is a very important sector for all over the world. We have some specific research fields like packaging design, innovative materials, which apply also in many areas, the digitization of existing traditional pictures or other things like that. Color is quite important for us. We process color, we measure color, we compare color, so we can have a technical view of the color you design. Some of you, of course, if you are artists or designers, you design a color, but then you want to see it correctly somewhere else, printed, or to be in a screen. This color needs to be done under specific guidelines, and there are a lot of technical issues behind this. Of course, security printing is one of our issues. Some ideas on what we do, maybe it's quite Chinese for you, but we say they are Greek to them, to people that don't speak any Greek. For example, we try to print. You have an artwork which normally should be printed with silk screen printing with 40 colors. We now develop a technology that we can print it with only 6 or 7 colors. And there is a lot behind this, a lot of research behind this issue. I will not stay with unknown terms like raster. It's not important for you. What we do also is to develop ceramic pigments for coloring and printing, which can be new identities, like to be more sustainable within the environment, for example, and they would not use a lot of energy to be productive, and of course other things which are not interesting. Some colleagues from a project. We do a lot in this area as a union of graduates and engineers, a lot of different events like this one, for packaging. Regarding textile and clothing, we have these lectures, these modules at the Athens, at the Department of Graphic Art Technology at Athens TEI. We have materials. We have silk screen printing, which is the process for printing textiles and clothing. Digital printing, which is a very big issue nowadays. Printed electronics, and a way that we can print something that can be interactive. And of course, interactive film functionality with various printed matters. It's a lot of areas that we search about. We have this research institute that we do a lot of work on this issue, and I will not stay with this. You can contact us, all of us, if you are interested in something that could be interesting for you from this area, which is mostly unknown. Everyone knows graphic designers, but we are not that thing. We are something different. And we're really happy that we are here. So, thank you very much.
Some of the technologies of tomorrow can be implemented today in the cities we live, and also using wearables and smart clothes and other things that we will talk about later on. So, thanks, Maria.
Thank you, Stavri. Hello, everyone. I'm Maria Paneta. I'm an architect based in London, and today I will be talking to you about innovation in fashion using wearable devices. So I will be presenting you Sarotis. Sarotis was my graduate project from the Bartlett UCL 2016. So this snapshot from Kubrick's 2001 Odyssey represents for me how we perceive a project when it first starts. So it's like an unknown object, a weird structure that we want to go closer to. So for this project, I will be guiding you through psychology, science, architecture, design and fashion. Let's start from Heinz von Forster, who is a philosopher. So, according to his theory, when we perceive our environment, it's we who invent it. Metzinger is another important person who talks about how we perceive the world through our senses. This video couldn't play. So imagine that you're touching a wall. So this wall has multiple layers that your body can understand, which can be texture, color, all these thin lines, thinner lines. So all these layers, when you touch the wall through touch, kind of combine in your skin, combine with your mind, your previous knowledge, experience, whatever is on your mind. So that's the way we perceive our the world through the senses. And so I'm interested in how the body can perceive the environment. Each one of us has a different perception of the world because each one of us is unique, has different things in their mind, different kinds of experiences.
An operating system, and it's not working particularly well. But,
okay, so we started through the start of the research, going through several experiments that have to do with psychology mostly. So another one, they used goggles that would invert your vision. So let me get you a preview of that. Has to to wear those special glasses. And they will be seeing the world upside down. At first, they cannot operate. They can do anything. So you cannot even pour milk in there. I mean, yeah, it's impossible. You can see everything like quite different. So, as time goes by, she can kind of operate, and she can do simple tasks. So she can draw. Draw her name. And then if somebody watches this through the end, she can even ride a bike, which is really unique if we imagine that she sees everything upside down. So this proves that our brain is elastic and we can actually transform perception. And so that will be kind of the focus of this study. So let's go back. There are a lot of references for us in the art world. This comes from the 60s. This is Rebecca Horn, and she wears these really hard prosthetic arms, and she tries to feel the built environment through those. The next one, Walter Pickler. Also 70s, he makes like wearable situations, wearable structures that can feel like a TV or maybe a small living space. And so this is us today. So everyone is using a mobile phone. Everybody's using all those rigid, hard prosthetic screens. And we cannot detach from those. It's like our own reality. So we thought, what if we try to use something less hard than a mobile phone screen that could actually attach on your skin, and it could be more stretchy and flexible than those? This is like a classic. This is Stellar. An artist who does hard prosthetic devices, and the reference comes from science. It's like a prosthetic limb. So there is a lot of research in science with regards to stretchable materials. These are hydrogels. So the new generation of these hydrogels are mostly used in medicine for drug delivery, and can also contain some of those light or micro circuits. There is also another technology we would like to work with. So this is SLAM, simultaneous localization and mapping. So what this thing does is that it locates your position on a map that you actually scan. So you scan something and it locates your position in the world. And that's pretty awesome because it's going to be integrated in most mobile devices. So everyone will have the accessibility to this kind of technology. You can actually scan in a 3D point cloud like your environment, which is pretty amazing for me and the team. So we tried. So all this might seem scattered. Scientific research, material research, 3D scanning. So all these will lead through the final prototype for Sarotis. So we started working on some material experiments. Unfortunately, we cannot see this video on this PC. But what we did is that we played with different with inflation So this is silicon, and this is this has different types of cells. So we try to inflate this soft material to see what kind of outcome we would have. And we use different kinds of paint, different kinds of thickness to see what kind of outcome that our wearable would have. And so this was our first prototype. You could wear it on your hand. It contained 9 channels, LED lights, and it's activated by touch. So you touch the sensor, and this starts to turn the light on and off, and it also inflates, so you can feel pressure in your skin. And we also had some material light experiments, so we use different kinds of lights. I will show you online the next prototype that could operate with the VR headset. So more about the technology we used for our working prototype. So we created a special application in Unity. This program is used mostly for developers that do a lot of virtual reality. So this could use 3D scan data from our scanning device. And this could be led in Arduino that could control our soft robot. And how this works. So, when a user goes closer to an object, see the hand, they wear the soft part. So when they go closer, this thing inflates. So unfortunately, this is not live, but you can imagine that this goes towards that, and this like goes. The user wears a piece on the neck, two soft pieces on the legs, and in the waist they have an actuation belt. So they 3D scan the environment. This device gets data from what is close to you, and the devices you will be wearing on your neck and legs inflate accordingly. So this is the belt, this is the piece that goes to the neck, these are the pieces that go to the legs. The case is 3D printed, and these soft pieces are is casted silicone made by a laser cut mold. This is the core of the mechanism, so it contains like the Arduino microcontroller, the micro pumps, and also the technology that bridges the 3D scanner with the pumps. So we made an experiment. We had those people wear this weird piece, and we let them experience a space that they could not see in an empty room. And then we asked them to sketch what they saw. So, you can watch the video. with the binding procedure, how the participants understood the space. And I will go through this quickly, because these are material experiments for our last piece. So we were really interested into fashion. Our study was a two-part study, so at first we had to cover a technical part to make a working prototype, and then we actually had to create a piece that could be what we envisioned, that the future interfaces in a really futuristic city would be. So we had a lot of references from the fashion world. So these are Hussein Chalayan, Iris van Herpen, and Y3. So let's... collaborated with Intel in 2017 so as to create an interactive belt and glasses. So this could actually scan human feelings. So this was exhibited in the New Museum in London last January. And these things were kind of linked to a projection. So he would illustrate how people feel on a screen. And a couple of videos we could watch. He could do kinds of biosensing, sensing of brain waves, respiration, heart rate. And in the same installation, he had this flower would open and close according to the user's feelings. Our next reference was Iris van Herpen, whose work is mostly in immaterial. So Yamamoto is a pioneer in textiles. He was one of the first designers to use new materials and new textiles to make unique garments. So that vision of life in the future cities was really appealing to us, and we would like to totally engage. Our final prototype was Sarotis that consists of two pieces, one neck piece and one like the side part of your body. It reflects how the future interfaces could actually look like and could mitigate the distance between our skin and the rest of the surroundings. So with regard regards to our vision, people could actually interact in the future cities wearing wearable stretchy dark devices on the skin. So enjoy the short film we have made.
It's a pleasure to be here. My name is Stavri Nikolov. I'm the founding director of Digital Spaces Living Lab. And we are one of the living labs. People will ask me what is a living lab, but I'll tell you later. One of the leading living labs in Europe, testing wearable devices and also mobile apps and location-based services in various kinds of contexts and cities. Today I'm here to tell you more about Wear Sustain. This is a project that has been mentioned already several times. Before I do this, I also want to thank the Foundation for hosting this event. It's a lovely setting for in an old, very beautiful building for what is, we hope, the technology of the future. So hopefully some of you will be the people who will come up with novel ideas about wearable devices and new smart clothes and which we can see pretty soon. And Wear Sustain is all about this. It's a great opportunity for designers, artists, and technologies to work together and realize some new novel ideas and make them products which we hopefully can see soon in Europe. So, let me turn this around a little bit. Okay. So my part of my presentation will be quite administrative, so it will be a little bit boring because I have to tell you a little bit about the project and how you can apply for funding and how it all works. So hopefully bear with me. I will show you later on some of the selected projects from the first call. So this will be hopefully more inspiring than the application procedures, but okay. So what is Wear Sustain? So it's a project, 2-year project that's funded by the European Union Horizon 2020 Research and Innovation Initiative. It's all about technologists and artists working together with, it's not clear who exactly coming up with the innovative and crazy ideas, but working together to implement them and build new wearables, new smart clothes, new e-textiles, new materials that will be products of today and of the future. And do this, that's very important, in a sustainable and ethical way. And I'll be talking about a lot during the course of today. And the over the 2 years that the project will run, this is this year and next year, until the end of 2018, Wear Sustain brings together European wearable technology and smart textile stakeholders to address core ethical and sustainable issues and to do a lot of research, testing, and implementation. The project is run by seven organizations in several countries. The coordinator is IMEC, which is a very big, probably the biggest research institute in Belgium, in Brussels. There are two London-based universities, the University of the Arts in Berlin, and three smaller companies in Italy, Bulgaria, and in Brussels. The main aims of the project, as we defined them more than a year ago, and we try to implement them now, is the following. First one is to develop a sustainable European network of stakeholders and hubs. So basically organizations ranging from big ones to small ones to individuals, to connect and push the boundaries in design and development of sustainable and ethical wearables, electronics, and smart textiles. Second very important aim is to actually encourage cross-border and cross-sector collaboration. There has been very little of it in Europe, and the aim of this project is actually to build bridges between companies, between individuals working in all these areas in different parts of Europe. And I'll show you a network that already works and which you can use and hopefully to support your application, but also in the future to find partners and service providers. Then to develop a framework which with which future prototypes can be made. So basically put designers and artists in contact with makerspaces, fab labs, design studios, organizations that can help you build prototypes, improve your prototypes in the future. And then lead the emergence of innovative approaches to design, production, and manufacturing. And last but not least, make citizens, entrepreneurs, and other stakeholders more aware of the ethical and aesthetic issues in making and use of wearable technology. And hopefully, seeing some projects, you will understand what we mean by this. So, ethics and sustainability concerns. Where sustain? You see there's a sustain even in the name of the project, which we put later on. It was initially called WHERE. Critical concerns towards data ethics and sustainability include. First one is a major concern that we and many people have is that the amount of data that wearable technologies capture, in particular the use of personal data, is rising, and it's not very clear who owns the data that wearables collect, where the data is stored, who can have access to it, and whether the use of this data is actually the intended use of this data. And with the design of novel wearable devices, it's really difficult for most of the designers of such devices to figure out all these technical issues. It's even more difficult for users to do that. So it needs a lot of explanation, but it needs also a lot of thinking about, because if data is not available, a lot of services don't work. So it's a matter of finding the right balance in our society between what data is collected, how it is used, and how useful it is and used by the companies or designers of such device. Also, the environmental, economic, and sustainable impact of the electronic textiles and fashion industry on the society. It's very important to study all these issues and to always keep them in mind when designing new smart clothes and new wearables. So, this is a scheme that basically shows you the four pillars, the four main elements of the project. And I will go to one by one now to them to try to explain what activities are planned and what we are doing within the framework of the project. First one is actually sustainable innovation. So what we've been doing is to organize two open calls, cross-border and cross-sector. Within the budget, there's a budget for teams to be funded. It's 2.4 million euros for the two calls. And each team, which is selected by a selection procedure, I'll explain later on how it works, gets 50,000 euros of funding and support. And so basically, if you do the maths, you will see that we have roughly a budget to fund 48 such teams or in the two funding calls. in the two open goals, and one has finished, and the second one actually opened yesterday night, and will be open until the 15th of January. So that's the second and last opportunity to apply for funding within this project. And the aim of the funding is actually to support a team of artists and designers with a great novel idea, to take it from prototype level to close to market. And I'll come to this later on to explain what kind of projects and maturity of the project we're looking at. Second is actually to create an ecosystem, or rather to help see the emerging ecosystem in Europe in the field of wearables and e-textile. And what we've been doing is actually mapping this emerging ecosystem and building a whole new platform that I will show you a little bit during my presentation now, and then we'll show you more during the last session of the question and answers, how this platform works, what kind of information you can find if you want to apply, but also if you want to find partners or service providers. And this is quite a powerful platform that has been built mainly by a company based in Belgium called We Connect Data. They develop very interesting software to map ecosystems and allow people to explore information about them. Third is actually knowledge exchange, mainly through organizing events and networking, symposia, like the events that we organize today here. And the first call opening for Central and Eastern Europe was in a rather different looking place, much more of a maker space. This is a Smart Fab Lab, the only fabrication lab in Sofia, in Bulgaria, where makers normally will gather together to use various kind of digital and other old-fashioned tools and hammer prototypes. So we organize as a consortium many such events and meetings throughout the whole of Europe. And for the second call, there are at least 6 or 7 planned. You can see them on the website of the project. And if you have partners or people who you want to work with, apply with, and so on, you can also tell them about these other events in other parts of Europe so that they can visit them too. And then there's this big theme of ethics and sustainability, looking at, as I mentioned already, personal data and how it's used and stored and so on. Environmental issues, footprints, and also how wearables are produced, what materials are used, where they are produced, how they are recycled, upcycled, and so on. Also critical issues, societal issues like labor practices, supply chains, commerce, and also the business models of making and selling wearables and smart clothes, and how we can make them sustainable. This is the platform I mentioned about. You can find it at this URL. It's a subdomain of wearsustain.eu, which is the main site of the project. It's called network.wearsustain.eu. And basically, what it does is, I'll switch to try to show you a live, very short demo. Page. This is what you will get. You will see a short introduction and something called Explore the System. You see how many organizations which are divided in different groups are listed. But basically you go to explore the ecosystem, which is here. So, and what you see is that currently there are nearly 500 members, different organizations that are registered in the platform. And they vary from creative professionals, artists, designers, technology people and organizations, creative innovation hubs, academia, investors. You can find incubators that support wearable projects. You can find any other organizations. Here in the special group, you will see the wear projects. These are the selected wear projects that are running, so you can see progress they make during the 6 months. They get support and incubation.
You can see also information about the WEAR consortium partners, but very importantly, you can see the, what we call the active WEAR sustained hubs. And these are really organizations with a lot of expertise in wearables and smart textiles, and there are about 60 of them. So each team, after it's selected, will get a home hub, and the home hub can be only one of these active wear sustained hubs. And the home hub is actually the hub where this, it's like the home where this project is supported and developed, and where the team works on a daily basis. So it may be a maker space, a design studio, it may be a university that will support the project and the team. What's interesting also is that you can, you have other filters down there, so you can search, for instance, you can go and look for, tell me out of these wear sustained hubs, which one will offer certain kind of services.
So you go here and you say wear sustained hub.
Profile. This is the profile. So you get some basic information, website and so on, but a short description. You get information about the services they offer, and these services are generally offered to anyone out there. It's not only to our teams. The selected teams can use some of these services and pay for them through a voucher system, which I will explain a little bit later. But generally, you get a lot of information, and then down there, you can get also information. Here you see also relationships, which is how this organization relates to other organizations in the whole ecosystem, whether they are partners or one has funded the other, whether they work together on certain projects, and so on. So, in effect, this is a graph which I can show you later on in the last part of the of tonight's event, which shows all the actors in the current wearable ecosystems and how they are related to each other. And you can see, for instance, a design studio, the main designers it works with, the universities that it works with, and maybe if there are some teams that already use its services, they will be all linked there. So it's a very interesting and powerful way to explore the European ecosystem in this respect. As I mentioned, we had our first open call in the spring, and then in the summer, 22 teams have been selected to get funding of 50,000 euros. And then in the network, we have now more than 50 hubs and 100 experts that help them to develop their projects. And you can find a full list of the teams that have been selected, and also links to their profiles to see what progress they have made since the summer and the beginning of their projects on this URL. You can find it easily through the main website. And I will just show you a very brief sample of a few projects that have been selected, just to get an idea of what kind of projects we are aiming at. Bravas is a project about mood-based music recommenders. So they use brain waves to actually see what your mood is, and then will recommend music to you depending on whether you're happy or sad or angry and so on. Air Leap is developing a special smart mask that will try to help you fight air pollution by actually getting information about your environment, and also switching filters and telling you to put on and on off the mask depending on how polluted the air around you is. Breathe is a wearable and smart collection of garments to aid people with proper breathing during yoga practices and everyday life. The Eye is a very interesting fashionable wear vision device. It's like a small camera which you wear on you, connected wirelessly to your smartphone for blind and visually impaired people. And Koba is actually a team of two ladies who is now they're building the first dedicated wearable and textile shop in the heart of Berlin in Germany, and will be supporting other teams also across Europe by building this physical shop where you can go and buy components and they have a blog where they also publish a lot of interesting information about how to do different things. And more information, as I said, can be found on this address. So for some of you, I think that for the majority of you, their interest in where will be how a team can apply for funding. But I wanted to also briefly mention some other rules that people can have in the WEAR project. And these are, some of you can become mentors, like main or other mentors to teams. And some organizations, their leaders can make them hubs, home or other hubs to teams. And some of you can become also reviewers. So the role of mentors, it's actually to advise teams how to make good progress with their projects and to give them overall advice, especially the role of a main mentor. It's like a tutor kind of role for the next 6 months after selection to help the team, to put them in contact with other mentors, to help them improve their business plan, their go-to-market strategy, their prototypes and so on. So main mentors have different expertise. Some of them are like more technical people, others are more business, legal kind of experts, depending on the needs of the team and what they need most. Hubs are actually local ambassador centers that form the crucial structure and the backbone of the WEAR ecosystem in Europe. You can think about various organizations that have become hubs. They range from universities, research centers, design studios, fab labs, makerspaces, incubators, accelerators, and so on. But basically, they help projects and teams and startups develop their prototypes and products. That's one of their main roles. And currently, there are 64 active WEAR hubs listed, and you can see them all through the network WearSustain.eu system. Just search for active WEAR hubs. Now, both mentors and hubs actually provide mentors provide mentorship, but hubs provide support services to teams in a range of areas, and they range from ethics and sustainability to design and aesthetics, ICT technology, prototyping and manufacturing, data and data models, user-centered design, validation, living lab experiments, testing of these devices and smart clothes, business advice and services, venturing in terms of securing follow-on funding, and legal advice. Reviewers, this I've mentioned only briefly, but basically we have in place a two-tier system where applications are first reviewed by three reviewers normally, and then the best 40 are sent to the jury that is an international jury of experts that will actually interview them through live pitching. So we have a panel of, I don't know, 60, 80 probably reviewers from all across Europe to review the initial applications. So you can become also a reviewer if you're an expert in one of these fields. So now coming to the practical details. As I said, Open Call 2 opened yesterday on the 15th of November. The deadline for submission of applications is the 15th of January 2018. Selected teams get 50,000 euros of funding. And the scope is wearables and e-textiles worn the body that may collect body data or data about your environment. So that's quite an important sentence. We've been asked many times. We've tried to somehow define the scope of this project. So we're talking about wearables, e-textiles, data collection, definitely something you wear on your body. So it's not Internet of Things project. It's something you wear on your body. It may collect data about your body. It may collect data about your environment. It may do both. That's perfectly all right. And the nature of the project should be interdisciplinary artists and designers working with technology. So that's very critical also that you have at least one person who's a technology person and one who's an artist in the team. You may have more, but at least one of a kind. Okay? So What are wearables? Another question we get quite often. I mean, it's up to you. You have seen some very good examples in the keynote of novel technology and wearables. But basically, it may be something that you is hidden in your shoes, or maybe sensors in your pants, dresses, new goggles, new jewelry, anything that you wear on you and provides you with novel functionality, with novel and clever ways of leading your life and doing what you normally do, is perfectly all right. So, if you are selected, what happens then? So the 50,000 euros come into three installments. You get 25,000 at start, which includes a system of innovation vouchers of three types, depending on the services that I listed in one of the previous slides. Then there's another 15,000 that come after a successful midterm evaluation, which for the second call will be in June 2018. And finally, 10,000 after the final evaluation in September 2018. So we're talking about a six-month window from start of project until end of September 2018. So the 15,000 come actually in two forms. And one is a sum to be spent on prototype developments and salaries, which may range between 35,000 and 40,000. And the rest, which comes into innovation vouchers, which ranges between 10 and 15,000, which are aimed at support that you will get. So basically, if someone is a hub, for instance, or a mentor from the network, and you need their services, and then you will get a quote from them. This will be agreed with the coordinator of the project, and they will get paid directly through the voucher system. Again, a repeat of what I mentioned, that you need at least one collaborator from the art or design sector and at least one collaborator from the technology or ICT or engineering sector. By collaborators, I mean at least one person. And the team may consist of more than one co-applicant from each sector, of course. Submitted proposals are considered as eligible if the proposing individuals have or are prepared to set up a legal entity. So you may have a company or other legal entity. Or you may not have such, but if you're successful and you get the funding, you have to incorporate such a legal entity. And all applicants must be citizens or residents of one of the 28 countries in European Union and associated non-EU countries. And there is a possibility also to involve, not as whole teams, but individual members of outside the EU. But for this, you'll have to talk more about with the coordinator. So now I come to the themes for the Open Call 2. They are slightly different from Open Call 1 themes, although broadly in line. So you have to think carefully about these themes and how your proposal addresses them. So the first one is environmental sustainability. So use, reuse, or waste. How will your team develop new wearables using technologies, textiles, and materials that engage with sustainable use, reuse, or recycling and repair? And there are some concerns which we have in our society, and then a major concern that we try to ask people to address in their proposals. And they're listed here. All this information is on the website, so you can read it very carefully afterward. Second one is energy, so batteries and energy sources and generation. How will your team develop wearable devices or smart textiles that harvest or make use of alternative energy? It may be, for instance, energy solutions that utilize the body as an energy source in a non-invasive way. So maybe heat, breathing, movement, steps, and so on can be used to generate energy that can power your wearables or smart clothes. Next one is sourcing and life cycle. And this is about how will you make products and services or processes that create limited carbon or waste footprint. Will you develop and use design principles centered around simulating or directly utilizing the patterns and features observed in natural ecosystems, like biomimetic. So this is also a very interesting theme. Next one is about ethics and data collection and privacy. How will your team develop wearable devices or smart textiles that minimize the negative impact of privacy invasion and personal data collection on users? Next one is on ethics, social workplaces, and so on. How will your team develop wearable devices or smart textiles that consider social or workplace ethics in their design and production? So how are wearables made and so on? And the final one is actually on body psychology and somatics. So how does your team address and combat the negative impact of wearable technology and smart textiles on the body? Because depending on what materials are used and how they're used, well, there are doubts that there may be some negative impacts, and these need to be taken into account, studied, and minimized and addressed in proposals. And the good news is also that if you have a very crazy idea, it doesn't fit quite well into any of these themes, there's also an open category. So you can still apply, but need to think whether your proposal will be addressing some of the previous themes that are listed above. So now in terms of maturity of what you apply with, so of your prototype or your project, Open Call 2, like Open Call 1, is aimed at projects that have a working prototype of TRL. This is the so famous technology readiness level scale that is used a lot now by the European Commission and many other organizations. But basically, you need to start from somewhere here. So you have research to prove feasibility or proof of concept on the bench scale. And the expectation is that in the next 6 months, you will, if you're successfully developing and improving your prototype and your project, you'll get maybe somewhere close to TRL 7 or TRL 8. So we're not talking about ready-made products. We're not talking about something that's ready to be sold in the first months of your project. But it needs to be more than just an idea on a sheet of paper. You need to have some kind of working prototype. So to be close to TRL 3 or TRL 4. And here, if you're interested to apply, perhaps you can come and talk to me later on what one of the members of our consortium, Barry, has done very nicely is to try to take the more technical TRL levels and explain them better for people who are more with an artistic background and design background, and give some examples of the wear definition of what a TRL means in the context of wearables and smart clothes. Okay, applications will be done like with the previous open call by a platform called F6S. Perhaps some of you who have applied like in business competitions have heard about it or know it. It's widely used around the world. So you need to create an account there and fill in a lot of the information that's needed to apply. And the application structure, now this is, there may be slight differences from what I tell you, because this is the application structure for Open Call 1. We decided that it will be more or less the same for Open Call 2, but the team members from the consortium have been reviewing it once again in the last few days. So basically what you need, so there may be some very small differences from what you have here written. Go to the website and there you'll get the latest information. So basically what you need to provide is an executive summary of your project, a presentation of the team, their expertise, previous related projects to wearables, CVs, then a project pitch, which is 5 pages where the project is proposed on the basis of the NAPS method, need, approach, benefit, and competition. A prototype plan of how the team will develop over the course of the next 6 months their project. And then a concrete business case for the application of the idea, which is maximum 1 page. And a video pitch of the project, so 3 minutes consisting of all the above topics. And this is up to you to decide what to put in the video. Right, and it, the end, because time is running out, I want to very briefly tell you, go back to sustainability. So I will probably skip these two slides because I don't have much time, and time I think is running out. But what I want to tell you is that many of you, I guess, are designers and artists, and designers and artists have a great role to play in the world, because they can first communicate the importance of sustainability to the rest, and always somehow take it into account when creating their design and art for novel clothes and novel wearables. And to support them, we have decided to, in the project, that's an effort that's going on from month one of the project, is to create a strategy toolkit where, which is aimed at the future artists and technologies, to help them actually address a lot of these sustainability issues that we've discussed today. And we collect feedback from teams, how what practical sustainability issues they face, and how through the course of their projects they may modify things to make their wearables and textiles more sustainable, but also from hubs and other organizations that support them. And our role is to try to put all this information together into a strategy toolkit, which will get all this information during the course of the project, and basically will be available online as a special kind of booklet with good practices, with things about innovation and collaboration in terms of sustainable business models, also the ecosystem that exists, and the sustainability aspects of various organizations, the data use that we've discussed, and storage, and created positive environmental, economic, and social impacts. And all this will be presented to designers and to teams that will apply, and hopefully others that will develop such devices in the future, well beyond the course of this project, to help them actually address sustainability and make it like the core of the design of such new wearables and smart clothes, because we believe that, and many people believe that this is very important. Like if you look at, for instance, the number of mobile phones and other devices that we use more and more in our consumer society, we need to think about how they're produced, where they go, and really how they're designed right from the scratch. So sustainability is really very important. And with this, I want to thank you for your attention. And if you have any queries and so on, I'll be happy to answer them during the last session from 7 to 8. You can always consult, that's the first choice, where sustain.eu is the main site. And you can, if you have questions, you can reach the whole Where Sustain Consortium by writing to this email, info@wheresustain.eu. And thank you very much. And then there will be four very interesting presentations. Two of them will address some of these issues that I mentioned, and so you'll see them in practice done here in Greece, and that's very interesting. So we'll go back to more practical cases, and two others are about novel devices that are being developed also here in Greece and elsewhere. So please be back in 10 minutes. So in 6:25 we continue. Thank you.
Second floor down.
Please, President.
president of the Hellenic Textile Engineers Association, lecturer in Piraeus University of Applied Sciences, Faculty of Engineering, Department of Textile Engineering, Piraeus, Greece. Θα μας αναπτύξει το δικό του το θέμα και από ό,τι άκουσα από τον κύριο Νικόλοφ, παρουσιάζει πολύ ενδιαφέρον. Έχετε το λόγο, κύριε Λούρη.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I'll give my presentation in Greek because most of the people here are Greek students, and I have already promised this to their teachers, and who are very good colleagues and friends of mine. So, σας χαιρετώ. Θα ξεκινήσουμε. Δεν ξέρω να ακούγομαι. θα μιλήσουμε για τα... Oh, I forgot to say that I constructed the slides in a way, in English, in a way that also English-speaking people can follow the presentation very easily, so they won't miss anything. Θα μιλήσουμε λοιπόν για τα έξυπνα κλωστοφαντουργικά προϊόντα και πώς αυτά μπορούν να οδηγήσουν τον κλάδο της μόδας στη λεγόμενη κυκλική οικονομία, δηλαδή σε μια πιο οικολογική και βιώσιμο, ένα πιο οικολογικό και βιώσιμο μοντέλο παραγωγής. Να ξεκινήσουμε από έναν ορισμό για το τι είναι τα smart textiles. Θα λέγαμε λοιπόν ότι ουσιαστικά είναι όλα τα κλωστοφαντουργικά είδη, συμπεριλαμβανομένων βεβαίως και των ενδυμάτων, τα οποία εκτός από τις παραδοσιακές τους ιδιότητες έχουν και κάποιες άλλες ιδιότητες και κυρίως έχουν μία αλληλεπίδραση με το περιβάλλον και αναλόγως εκτελούν κάποια έξυπνη λειτουργία. Αν θα θέλαμε να κάνουμε μια κατηγοριοποίηση ως προς τον τρόπο λειτουργίας τους, θα μπορούσαμε να τα διακρίνουμε σε κλωστοφαντουργικά, έξυπνα κλωστοφαντουργικά υλικά, τα οποία εκτελούν κάποια φυσική, χημική ή βιολογική διεργασία, κάποια άλλα που εκτελούν ηλεκτρονικές λειτουργίες ή computing, υπολογιστική και networking, δικτύωση, και βεβαίως έχουμε και περιπτώσεις όπου μπορεί να έχουμε συνδυασμό αυτών των δύο. Μιλώντας έτσι πολύ γρήγορα για να καταλάβουμε λίγο το εύρος αυτών των διαφορετικών λειτουργιών που μπορούν να εκτελέσουν, θα λέγαμε ότι στην πρώτη κατηγορία ανήκουν τα χρωμοτροφικά υλικά, δηλαδή υλικά που αλλάζουν χρώμα αναλόγως εξωτερικών ερεθισμάτων, κυρίως της θερμοκρασίας. Ίνες με μνήμη σχήματος, που σημαίνει ότι μπορούν να μεταβάλουν το σχήμα τους στη γεωμετρία τους και να επανέρχονται πάλι σε αυτή αναλόγως των εξωτερικών συνθηκών, πάλι κυρίως εξαιτίας της θερμοκρασίας. Θερμορυθμιζόμενα υλικά, δηλαδή υλικά τα οποία έχουν την ικανότητα να αποθηκεύουν ενέργεια, θερμική ενέργεια και να την εκλείουν με πιο αργούς ρυθμούς, άρα δημιουργώντας έτσι δυνατότητες να φτιάξουμε ρούχα ή υλικά τα οποία επεμβαίνουν και ρυθμίζουν καλύτερα τη θερμοκρασία σε εφαρμογές που θέλουμε. Βιοενεργά υλικά, βιοενεργές ίνες που αλληλεπιδρούν με στοιχεία του ανθρωπίνου σώματος σε επίπεδο βιολογικό. Αυτοκαθαριζόμενες ίνες. Νανοκάψουλες, οι οποίες μπορούν να ενσωματώνονται στις ίνες και αναλόγως να εκτελούν κάποια λειτουργία, όπως το να εκλείουν τη στιγμή που θέλουμε κάποιο φάρμακο ή ίσως κάποιο προστατευτικό άλλο, κάποια προστατευτική άλλη χημική ουσία, αναπερίπτωση. Και στα ηλεκτρονικά είναι ίσως λίγο πιο ξεκάθαρο σε όλους μας, καθώς όλοι έχουμε ένα κινητό, όλοι μπαίνουμε στο ίντερνετ, καταλαβαίνουμε περισσότερο. Μιλάμε για αγώγιμες ίνες, μιλάμε για ηλεκτρονικούς αισθητήρες που μπορεί να αισθάνονται θερμοκρασία, πίεση, την εγκύτητα με ένα άλλο σώμα.
led εύκαμπτες οθόνες, κεραίες και άλλα ηλεκτρονικά εξαρτήματα, μεταξύ των οποίων και πηγές ενέργειας, μπαταρίες, πάνελ στα οποία συλλέγουν ηλιακή ενέργεια και ούτω καθεξής. Όσον αφορά τώρα την ενσωμάτωση, το βαθμό ενσωμάτωσης των έξυπνων κλωστοατομικών προϊόντων στα ρούχα μας, σε προϊόντα που φέρουμε πάνω μας, έχουμε αυτές εδώ τις δύο κατηγορίες. Τη βασική κατηγοριοποίηση των portable, των φορητών, που είναι τα κινητά τηλέφωνα, τα tablets, τα laptops, και έχουμε και τα wearable, τα φορετά. Ο όρος φορετά δεν μου άρεσε ποτέ ιδιαίτερα, αλλά παρόλα αυτά, επειδή κάνει μια ενδιαφέρουσα συνήχιση με το φορητά, τελικά ίσως να τον στο μέλλον να γίνει αποδεκτός. Εδώ λοιπόν έχουμε διάφορα αξεσουάρ, τα οποία είναι αυτά που όλοι γνωρίζουμε, τα οποία δεν ενσωματώνονται στα ρούχα. Τα φοράμε κυρίως σαν αξεσουάρ, όπως είναι τα έξυπνα ρολόγια, όπως είναι τα έξυπνα γυαλιά, ζώνες, οι οποίες έχουν πάνω κάποια ηλεκτρονικά στοιχεία και εκτελούν κάποια δουλειά. Και στη συνέχεια πάμε πλέον στα ηλεκτρονικά, τα οποία ενσωματώνονται στα ρούχα. Στην πρώτη κατηγορία έχουμε αυτά τα οποία είναι προσαρτημένα, δηλαδή αυτά τα οποία έχουν ραφτεί στα ρούχα, έχουν κρυφτεί σε τσέπες, έχουν μπει μέσα σε κάποια φόδρα, έτσι ώστε αισθητικά να μην επηρεάζουν το ρούχο και να κρατάνε μια λειτουργικότητα και επιπλέον να προστατεύονται και τα ίδια αυτά τα ηλεκτρικά και ηλεκτρονικά στοιχεία. Αυτή είναι η πιο απλή μορφή, όπου θα λέγαμε ότι σήμερα όλα τα προϊόντα που κυκλοφορούν και έχουν σχέση με ηλεκτρονικά κλειστοαντολικά ανήκουν σε αυτή την κατηγορία. Αν προχωρήσουμε περισσότερο, έχουμε ηλεκτρονικά προσαρμοσμένα πάνω στις δομές τις κλειστοαντολικές. Δηλαδή αρχίζουμε και κινούμαστε σε μικρότερη κλίμακα, και μιλάμε για ηλεκτρονικά εξαρτήματα που είναι συνήθως σε μέγεθος μικρών ή και νάνο ακόμη και τοποθετούνται πάνω σε ίνες με κόλληση, με κάποιο printing, εκτύπωση και είτε στο νήμα είτε στο ύφασμα από το οποίο δημιουργείται το ρούχο. Και τέλος έχουμε την κατηγορία με τη μεγαλύτερη δυσκολία και αυτή που ακόμη δεν έχει οδηγήσει σε πραγματικά πρακτικά προϊόντα τα οποία να υπάρχουν και να κυκλοφορούν στην αγορά, τα οποία είναι τα πλήρως ενσωματωμένα. Σε αυτή την περίπτωση μιλάμε για ηλεκτρονικά κυκλώματα τα οποία έχουν δημιουργηθεί από την ίδια την κλωστοφαντουργική δομή. Δηλαδή τα ίδια τα κλωστοφαντουργικά υλικά μας χτίζονται με τέτοιο τρόπο, δομούνται με τέτοιο τρόπο που να δημιουργούν τα ηλεκτρονικά κυκλώματα. Όσο πιο δεξιά πηγαίνουμε, τόσο πιο μακριά πηγαίνουμε από τα διαθέσιμα προϊόντα αυτή τη στιγμή στην αγορά. Και όσο πιο δεξιά πηγαίνουμε, τόσο περισσότερο αυξάνει η δυσκολία στο να πετύχουμε αυτό που θέλουμε. Μιλώντας για την τεχνολογική ετοιμότητα, για το επίπεδο, για την οριμότητα δηλαδή, στην οποία βρίσκονται αυτή τη στιγμή τα projects γενικότερα, τα ερευνητικά projects, αλλά και τα προϊόντα που κυκλοφορούν, που πρωτοεμφανίζονται στην αγορά, θα λέγαμε ότι τα έξυπνα κλωστοατομικά προϊόντα κατά κανόνα βρίσκονται σε χαμηλό βαθμό οριμότητας, σε χαμηλό επίπεδο τεχνολογικής ετοιμότητας. Συνήθως φτάνουμε μέχρι το επίπεδο 7, όπου σημαίνει ότι για να το ξεπεράσουμε και να το περάσουμε πλέον σε βιομηχανική κλίμακα, θα πρέπει να βρούμε λύσεις σε προβλήματα κατασκευαστικά τα οποία ακόμη δεν έχουν ξεπεραστεί. Αυτός είναι ο λόγος που τα περισσότερα έξυπνα κλωστοατομικά προϊόντα σήμερα είναι προϊόντα που γίνονται στο χέρι. δεν έχουμε έτοιμες βιομηχανικές μεθόδους για να τα παράξουμε σε μεγάλη κλίμακα. Ας δούμε λοιπόν αυτά τα προβλήματα που αντιμετωπίζουμε. Το πρώτο που μας κάνει πάρα πολύ δύσκολο το να πάμε σε πλήρη ενσωμάτωση και στην παραγωγή έτοιμων υφασμάτων τα οποία θα μπορούσε να τα πάρει η βιομηχανία ένδυσης και να τα χρησιμοποιήσει για να φτιάξει έξυπνα κλωστοβιβλικά προϊόντα. Το πρώτο πρόβλημα είναι ότι για να φτιάξουμε ρούχο θα πρέπει να κόψουμε το υφάσμα και να το ράψουμε. Πρέπει να έχουμε τη διαδικασία της κοπής και ραφής. Σε αυτή την περίπτωση θα έχουμε κόψιμο των κυκλωμάτων, διακοπή των γραμμών σύνδεσης και καταστροφή ακόμη των μικροηλεκτρονικών που βρίσκονται στο ύφασμα. Συνεπώς, αυτό είναι κάτι που είναι απαγορευτικό για να βοηθήσει το να δημιουργήσουμε υφάσματα έτοιμα να απορροφηθούν από την ένδυση. Η δεύτερη δυσκολία έχει να κάνει με το ότι τα περισσότερα κλωστοβαντερικά προϊόντα πρέπει να πλένονται. Άρα λοιπόν πρέπει να μιλάμε για υλικά τα οποία θα πρέπει να έχουν αντοχή στο πλήσιμο και μάλιστα αντοχή σε επανειλημμένα πολλά πλησίματα και πολλές φορές υπό δύσκολες συνθήκες, που σημαίνει ότι τα ηλεκτρονικά και εδώ η υλοποίηση ηλεκτρονικών τα οποία θα έχουν μεγάλη διάρκεια ζωής είναι πάλι δύσκολη και είναι ένα πρόβλημα που πρέπει να ξεπεραστεί. Το τρίτο θέμα, το τρίτο πρόβλημα έχει να κάνει με αυτό που είπαμε πριν, ότι η ενσωμάτωση δεν γίνεται πραγματικά μέσα στη δομή του υφάσματος. Συνήθως μιλάμε για προσαρτημένα ηλεκτρονικά και επειδή η ηλεκτρονική τεχνολογία δεν έχει φτάσει στο σημείο να έχει ούτε αυτό το βαθμό ελαστικότητας, ούτε την ικανότητα προσαρμογής σε τόσο μικρές κλίμακες πάνω σε ύφασμα και σε ίνες, καταλήγουμε να χρησιμοποιούμε μέχρι σήμερα πιο σκληρά υλικά, ηλεκτρονικά υλικά, τα οποία έχουν επίπτωση στο επίπεδο άνεσης του ρούχου. Είναι λοιπόν άλλο ένα θέμα το οποίο μας δυσκολεύει και είναι μια πρόκληση για το μέλλον για την εξέλιξη των ηλεκτρονικών. Το επόμενο σημείο είναι αυτό που συζητήσαμε. Δεν υπάρχουν τυποποιημένες μέθοδοι. Επομένως, ούτε τυποποιημένα υλικά, ούτε τυποποιημένες μέθοδοι. Άρα, πρέπει ο σχεδιαστής του ρούχου ή του έξυπνου κλωστοβιβλικού προϊόντος να κάνει ο ίδιος μόνος του μια πολύ μεγάλη έρευνα, τόσο για τα υλικά, τα κατάλληλα, όσο και για τη μέθοδο που θα τα προσθέσει στο ρούχο και θα υλοποιήσει το προϊόν του. Και βέβαια, όπως νομίζω ξέρουμε και καταλαβαίνουμε όλοι, είναι ένα νέο πεδίο τεχνολογικό, τα έξυπνα κλωστοβιβλικά, το οποίο είναι ένα εξαιρετικά πλούσιο διαθεματικό πεδίο, όπου αναγκαστικά για να προχωρήσει θα πρέπει να συμμετάσχουν στα έργα αυτά επιστήμονες και τεχνολόγοι από πάρα πολλές διαφορετικές ειδικότητες. Πέραν οπωσδήποτε των σχεδιαστών. Αυτό λοιπόν οδηγεί σε ένα νέο οικοσύστημα, το οποίο σιγά σιγά διαμορφώνεται, το οποίο έχει στο επίκεντρο βέβαια τα έξυπνα κλωστοβιβλικά, αλλά γύρω από αυτό περιστρέφονται νέες κυρίως, έχω βάλει με λίγο πιο ανοιχτό χρώμα, τους νέους παίκτες σε αυτή τη νέα αναδυόμενη αγορά, που είναι νέες εταιρείες, οι οποίες ασχολούνται με smart garments, smart textiles, startups δηλαδή, και επίσης εταιρείες συμβουλευτικών υπηρεσιών που ασχολούνται με νέα υλικά, με νέες μεθόδους παραγωγής, με νέες εφαρμογές και μπορούν να δώσουν οδηγίες, πληροφορίες, να ενισχύσουν όλο αυτό το έργο και των υπολείπων. Έχουμε οπωσδήποτε ερευνητικά ινστιτούτα και ακαδημαϊκά, υπάρχουσες κλωστοβιβλίες οι οποίες σταδιακά όσο εξελίσσεται ο τομέας των έξυπνων κλωστοβιβλικών προϊόντων θα μετακινούνται όλο και προς, θα μετασχηματίζεται σιγά σιγά σε εταιρείες υψηλής τεχνολογίας, βιομηχανίες υλικών και οπωσδήποτε βιομηχανίες ηλεκτρονικών και πληροφορικής. Το ερώτημά μας τώρα μπροστά σε αυτό, σε αυτές τις εξελίξεις που βρισκόμαστε είναι, μπορεί η νέα ανάπτυξη έξυπνων κλωστοβατολογικών προϊόντων, η ανάπτυξη νέων προϊόντων να δημιουργήσει σε μια πιο πράσινη οικονομία, σε, να είναι πραγματικά μια πράσινη ανάπτυξη. Η κατάσταση αυτή τη στιγμή, περίπου, έχει ως εξής. Κάθε άτομο στην Ευρωπαϊκή Ένωση καταναλώνει περίπου 15 τόνους αγαθών και παράγει κάθε χρόνο 4,5 τόνους σκουπίδια. Από αυτό ανακυκλώνεται περίπου λιγότερο από το μισό τοις εκατό. Σε μια έρευνα που έγινε στα πλαίσια μιας πτυχιακής εργασίας στο, στο ΑΕ Πειραιά τεχνολογικού τομέα, από το οποίο προέρχομαι και εγώ ως συνεργάτης. Μία λοιπόν έρευνα τέτοια έδειξε ότι, η οποία έγινε σε 250 άτομα, έδειξε ότι ένα ρούχο καινούριο φοριέται από τον αγοραστή του, τον πρώτο αγοραστή, φοριέται περίπου 7 φορές. Στη συνέχεια απορρίπτεται, δίνεται κάπου αλλού, μένει σε ένα σιρτάρι, σε μία ντουλάπα, αλλά πάβει να είναι ένα προϊόν που χρησιμοποιείται ενεργά, τουλάχιστον από τον πρώτο χρήστη του. Το μοντέλο που ακολουθείτε, λοιπόν, μέχρι σήμερα, είναι ένα γραμμικό μοντέλο οικονομίας. Ένα ανοιχτό γραμμικό μοντέλο οικονομίας, όπου ουσιαστικά παίρνει πρώτες ύλες από την φύση, και ενέργεια, πόρους γενικώς, αντλεί πόρους από τη φύση, παράγει αγαθά, τα αγαθά αυτά καταναλώνονται και στη συνέχεια πετιούνται, σαν σκουπίδια, απορρίπτονται. Η ανακύκλωση δεν είναι ιδανική λύση. Βοηθάει, αλλά δεν είναι ιδανική λύση. Αφού υπάρχει ένας καλύτερος τρόπος να χτυπήσουμε αυτό το πρόβλημα στη ρίζα του. Και αυτός ο τρόπος δεν είναι άλλος από το να σταματήσουμε να παράγουμε τόσα και να απορρίπτουμε τόσα πολλά απόβλητα, τόσα πολλά σκουπίδια. Ο τρόπος λοιπόν να το κάνουμε είναι το νέο μοντέλο που προτείνεται, που είναι το μοντέλο της κυκλικής οικονομίας. Σύμφωνα με αυτή τη λογική, τα προϊόντα τα οποία παράγουμε πρέπει να σχεδιάζονται εκ των προτέρων και να τα παράγουμε με στόχο μας να έχουν μεγαλύτερο κύκλο ζωής, να χρησιμοποιούνται περισσότερο από τους χρήστες. Στη συνέχεια, στον ίδιο κύκλο ζωής τους, να μπορούν να συνεχίσουν να παράγουν αξία. Και αυτό μπορεί να γίνει μέσα από τη δυνατότητα αποσυναρμολόγησής τους, επισκευής, τροποποίησής τους και επαναχρησιμοποίησής τους. Άρα ένα προϊόν δεν χάνει την αξία του, αλλά μπορούμε μέσα από ένα νέο μοντέλο και επιχειρηματικότητας και οικονομίας να το ανανεώσουμε, να το προσαρμόσουμε και να του ξαναδώσουμε αξία, έτσι ώστε να συνεχίσει να υπάρχει για πολύ καιρό. Ουσιαστικά, ενώ το μοντέλο της ευθύγραμμης, της ανοιχτής οικονομίας, όπου ουσιαστικά σαν μόνο όπλο έχει την ανακύκλωση, ξεκινάει από το σκεπτικό ότι όταν σχεδιάζουμε ένα προϊόν, το σχεδιάζουμε για να οδηγηθεί κάποια στιγμή στην ανακύκλωση, δηλαδή να απορριφθεί. Το μοντέλο της κυκλικής οικονομίας έχει μια τελείως άλλη φιλοσοφία. Αυτό που σχεδιάζουμε πρέπει να σχεδιάζεται εξ αρχής με τέτοιο τρόπο που να μπορεί να συνεχίσει να χρησιμοποιείται για πολύ καιρό ακόμη. Άρα είναι ένα άλλο μοντέλο προσέγγισης. Σε αυτή την προσπάθεια που τα τελευταία χρόνια ενισχύεται πάρα πολύ στα πλαίσια της Ευρωπαϊκής Ένωσης και δεν αποκλείεται στα επόμενα χρόνια να δούμε ακόμη και σε επίπεδο νομοθεσίας ευρωπαϊκής να απαιτούνται πλέον πράγματα που να οδηγούν στην κυκλική οικονομία. Τα έξυπνα κλειστοφαντολογικά προϊόντα και κυρίως το έξυπνο ένδυμα μπορεί να οδηγήσει δυναμικά, να είναι οδηγός σε αυτή την νέα οικονομία, στη νέα κυκλική οικονομία. Πώς μπορεί να γίνει αυτό? Ο σχεδιασμός των έξυπνων κλειστοφαντολογικών προϊόντων και ενδυμάτων έχει μία διαφορά, έχει κάποια χαρακτηριστικά τα οποία τον διαφοροποιούν από το fashion design και ταυτόχρονα το μετακινούν περισσότερο προς το industrial design. Νομίζω ότι μπορείτε λίγο να αντιληφθείτε αυτό που λέω. Ένα υλικό το οποίο σχεδιάζεται να έχει πάνω κάποια ιδιαίτερη λειτουργικότητα, θα χρησιμοποιηθούν γι' αυτό ιδιαίτερα υλικά, θα έχει πάνω ίσως κάποιους μικροεπεξεργαστές, ειδικά κυκλώματα. Χρειάζεται περισσότερο design, μοιάζει περισσότερο με τη βιομηχανική σχεδίαση, καθώς χρειάζεται περισσότερο χρόνο στην σχεδίασή του, στην έρευνά του, στην έρευνα των υλικών, στο πώς θα κατασκευαστεί, στο πώς μπορεί να περάσει σε βιομηχανική παραγωγή. Και οπωσδήποτε όλα αυτά σημαίνουν περισσότερο χρόνο. Σε αυτό εδώ το διάγραμμα προσπάθησα έτσι κάπως να δείξω αυτή την κατεύθυνση. Το industrial design που αφορά συσκευές όπως αυτοκίνητα, κινητά τηλέφωνα, ηλεκτρονικές συσκευές, ηλεκτρικές συσκευές σπιτιού και όλα αυτά, σαφώς ο χρόνος δημιουργίας ενός προϊόντος είναι πολύ μεγαλύτερος από τον χρόνο ζωής και το χρόνο δημιουργίας ενός ρούχου. Έχουμε δηλαδή και το fashion, τα smart textiles βρίσκονται στην πραγματικότητα κάπου ανάμεσα. Δηλαδή έχουμε μία κόντρα μεταξύ της λογικής industrial design όσον αφορά χρόνους και προοπτική ως προς τον κύκλο ζωής του προϊόντος με το fashion design που κάθε χρόνο προσπαθεί να μπει, όλο και περισσότερες εταιρείες προσπαθούν να μπουν μέσα στο fast fashion. Προσπαθούν να παράξουν όσο το δυνατόν γρηγορότερα περισσότερες κολεξιών, να αλλάξουν αντί 2-4 κολεξιών το χρόνο, μπορεί και λιγότερο, ή και κάθε μήνα να βγάζουν καινούργια συλλογή. Συνεπώς, το μοντέλο αυτό, το οποίο, του fast fashion, το οποίο τελικά οδηγεί σε ρούχα τα οποία θα φορηθούν στη ζωή τους 7 φορές και θα απορριφθούν άγνωστο πού, αν θα επαναχρησιμοποιηθούν ή όχι, το οποίο είναι καταστροφικό για τον πλανήτη μας, μπορεί στο μέλλον και όσο τα smart textiles μπαίνουν περισσότερο στη ζωή μας, να εξισορροπηθεί αυτό το μοντέλο από τα smart textiles. Πώς τώρα οι εταιρείες μπορούν να βγάλουν κέρδος από αυτή την ιστορία, από την κυκλική οικονομία? Ένας τρόπος είναι να δημιουργήσουν κέρδος από ήδη υπάρχοντα προϊόντα. Είτε προϊόντα τα οποία έχουν μείνει στο ράφι, μιλάω για εταιρείες που έχουν stop, δεν πουλήθηκε, έμεινε, είτε για ρούχα τα οποία είναι second hand. Σε αυτή την περίπτωση, παλιά ρούχα μπορούν να μετατραπούν σε έξυπνα ρούχα και να αποκτήσουν μια νέα αξία τα οποία θα τα οδηγήσει πάλι στην αγορά. Επίσης, μια άλλη μεγάλη κατηγορία κέρδους για πολλές εταιρείες, υπάρχουσες ή και καινούργιες, είναι η επισκευή ή το upgrade, σε περίπτωση που μιλάμε ήδη για έξυπνα ρούχα, μπορεί να έχουμε κάποιο upgrade σε ένα ήδη έξυπνο ρούχο, όπως κάνουμε με τα κινητά μας, που γίνεται upgrade το λειτουργικό του σύστημα. Και βέβαια από τις εταιρείες που αναφέραμε πριν, οι οποίες μπορούν να παρέχουν υπηρεσίες σε άλλες εταιρείες σχετικά με έξυπνα υλικά, έξυπνα προϊόντα, τρόπους παραγωγής. Και βέβαια η επαναχρησιμοποίηση των προϊόντων, η επαναχρησιμοποίηση των συστατικών, των τμήματων παλαιότερων προϊόντων, γι' αυτό πρέπει ότι σχεδιάζεται να γίνεται με προσοχή ώστε να μπορεί να αποσυναρμολογηθεί και να πάνε να χρησιμοποιηθούν κάποια τμήματά του. Κάτι που ήδη στη βιομηχανία των ηλεκτρονικών και την αυτοκίνητη βιομηχανία γίνεται ήδη. Και τέλος, στη νέα κατάσταση που θα βρεθούμε, θα βρεθούν σίγουρα οι εταιρείες οι οποίες θα δημιουργήσουν ένα brand name πάνω στα έξυπνα κλειστοβαντολογικά προϊόντα και για τα οποία θα αναπτυχθεί μια εμπιστοσύνη πελάτη και θα αποκτήσουν μια σταθερή πελατεία. Κάτι που λίγο πολύ το βιώνουμε σήμερα με τα κινητά τηλέφωνα, ας πούμε. Όπου κάποιοι είναι φανατικοί της Apple, κάποιοι άλλοι είναι φανατικοί της Samsung και πάλι λέγοντας. Κάτι τέτοιο θα βιώσουμε στο μέλλον για κάποιες μεγάλες εταιρείες οι οποίες θα προσφέρουν προϊόντα αξιόλογα και αξιόπιστα και θα αποκτήσουν σταθερή πελατεία και όνομα στην αγορά. Αν σκεφτούμε το μέλλον, λίγο φουτουριστικά ίσως, αν σκεφτούμε ένα μελλοντικό ρούχο, το οποίο δεν μπορώ να ξέρω και δεν ξέρω αν κάποιος από εμάς μπορεί να φανταστεί πώς θα είναι, αλλά αυτό δεν έχει σημασία, θα είναι ένα ρούχο το οποίο θα μπορεί να παρέχει διαρκή επικοινωνία με τους γύρω μας, μια διαρκή δικτύωση, χωρίς να χρειάζεται να κουβαλάμε το κινητό τηλέφωνο πάνω μας. Έτσι, θα κάνουμε το μανίκι μας και θα μιλάμε ή στο γιακά μας, χωρίς hands-free, χωρίς τίποτε. Θα έχει μία οθόνη εύκαμπτη καλής ευκρίνειας που θα μπορούμε να βλέπουμε πληροφορίες, ίσως να είναι και touch, δεν ξέρω. Ένα οπωσδήποτε βολικό πληκτρολόγιο που θα ανταποκρίνεται στις κινήσεις μας. Θα μπορεί να παίζει ήχους, μουσική, να ακούμε μηνύματα. Θα μπορεί να φωτίζει το περιβάλλον γύρω μας, τη στιγμή που θα το χρειαζόμαστε. Αν ξαφνικά βρεθούμε σε έναν σκοτεινό χώρο, μπορεί να φωτίζει το χώρο γύρω μας μέσα από LED. Θα μας ζεσταίνει όταν κάνει κρύο ή θα μας δροσίζει όταν κάνει ζέστη, αυτόματα χωρίς να κάνουμε τίποτα και χωρίς να βάζουμε να βγάζουμε κουφάν. Θα μπορεί να αλλάζει χρώμα ή και να φωτίζεται διαφορετικά, ανάλογα με τη δική μας επιθυμία. Μπορεί να αλλάζει και σχήμα, πιθανόν, χρησιμοποιώντας υλικά με μνήμη σχημάτος. Μπορεί να σκοτώνει μικροοργανισμούς, βακτήρια και να εξαφανίζει τις μυρωδιές, τις δυσάρεστες. Να ελέγχει το χώρο γύρω μας, όπως είδαμε και την παρουσίαση, την πολύ ενδιαφέρουσα πριν, και να μας δίνει αλάρμ, να μας ενημερώνει για το πού βρισκόμαστε, να αποφύγουμε κινδύνους ή ακόμη και να μας προστατεύσει στέλνοντας κάπου αλλού ένα σήμα, κάποιο αλάρμ. Να μας προστατεύει από εξωτερική ακτινοβολία. Να κάνει διαρκώς καταγραφή των βιωσιμάτων μας και άλλων δικτών που σχετίζονται με την υγεία μας και αυτόματα να μας δίνει προειδοποίηση ή για την κακή στάση του σώματός μας, είτε για κάποια κόπωση που πρέπει αν ανεβάσαμε πυρετό και δεν το έχουμε καταλάβει. Όλα αυτά μπορούν να γίνονται άμεσα και χωρίς να το σκεφτόμαστε καν. Οπωσδήποτε θα είναι αυτοκαθαριζόμενο και θα μπορεί να επισκευαστεί, να είναι αυτοεπισκευαστεί, στην περίπτωση που σκιστεί από ατύχημα. Και βέβαια θα προσφέρει τη δυνατότητα upgrade στο software του και ίσως σε κάποια συστατικά του ηλεκτρονικά. Όλα αυτά που λέμε σε εργαστηριακό επίπεδο και σε κάποιο βαθμό ίσως πρωτόλιο έχουν ήδη υλοποιηθεί. Άρα δεν μιλάμε για κάτι το οποίο ίσως βρίσκεται τόσο μακριά στο μέλλον. Ένα τέτοιο ρούχο που πάλι λέμε δεν ξέρουμε πώς ακριβώς θα μοιάζει, αλλά η μόδα θα μας πάει μπροστά και αργά ή γρήγορα, σίγουρα θα έχει πολύ μεγάλη αξία για αυτό που το φοράει. Και δεν θα είναι ένα ρούχο το οποίο θα το πετάξει εύκολα για να το αλλάξει με κάποιο άλλο. Συνεπώς, μοιραία οι εξελίξεις αυτές τεχνολογίας μεν, αλλά και μόδας, γιατί η μόδα είναι ο οδηγός που θα μας οδηγήσει σε όλα αυτά τα τελικά προϊόντα, θα οδηγήσει σε μια βιομηχανία και κλωστοφαντουργίας και ένδυσης, η οποία θα είναι πιο κοντά στο μοντέλο της κυκλικής οικονομίας. Ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ. Αν υπάρχουν κάποιες ερωτήσεις ίσως που γνωρίζω και μπορώ να απαντήσω. Ναι, Ήρυδα, ευχαριστώ. Περισσότερο ήταν μια ιδέα αυτό που πρότεινες και είναι μια πάρα πολύ ωραία ιδέα. Εξαιρετική ιδέα. Στην πραγματικότητα, οι ιδέες για τις εφαρμογές των έξυπνων γλωσσοφαντουργικών προϊόντων γενικότερα, εννοείται και ένδυσης, είναι απεριόριστες. Κάθε μέρα μπαίνω στο ίντερνετ και βλέπω 2-3 διαφορετικές καινούργιες ιδέες. Είναι πραγματικά ανεξάντλητο, οπότε είναι μια πολύ καλή ιδέα, ναι, θα μπορούσε. Γιατί ήδη γίνεται σε MEPATS να τοποθετούνται εμβόλια σε PATS και τα οποία μπορούν να διατηρηθούν κιόλας χωρίς να χρειάζεται ψυγείο και μεταφέρονται στην Αφρική και με το PATS μέσω του δέρματος περνάει σιγά σιγά το αντιβιωτικό ή το εμβόλιο στο σώμα. Είναι αμέτρητη η γκάμα των εφαρμογών. Ναι.
Τον αριθμό των καταναλωτών και ίσως να μην αγγίζει περισσότερο άτομα τα οποία να μην μπορούν να το πληρώσουν.
Ναι, πιστεύω ότι ίσως στην αρχή ναι. Όμως αν δούμε και τώρα τηρουμένα των αναλογιών τα έξυπνα μπουφάν, ας πούμε το μπουφάν της Google που έχει controls πάνω για να χειρίζεται κινητό, να ακούς τα μηνύματά σου κλπ. Να χειρίζεται ένα... να σου δίνει οδηγίες κλπ. Δεν είναι τόσο ακριβό. Δηλαδή, πολύ μεγάλη μερίδα του κόσμου, τουλάχιστον στις δυτικές κοινωνίες, μπορεί να το αποκτήσει. Από την άλλη, είναι κάτι σαν τα κινητά τηλέφωνα. Τα κινητά τηλέφωνα που παρήχαν τις εξαιρετικές ιδιότητες, κάποτε ήταν μόνο στην κατηγορία των 1.000 ευρώ. Ενώ τώρα βρίσκουμε αντίστοιχα τηλέφωνα που μπορούν να προσφέρουν περίπου τα ίδια με πολύ μικρές διαφορές, ήδη και κάτω από τα 200 ευρώ. Συνεπώς είναι κάτι που μπορεί να ξεκινήσει σαν κάτι πάρα πολύ ακριβό, αλλά σιγά σιγά, ναι.
Λοιπόν, παρακαλώ να συνεχίσουμε. Ναι. Ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ, κύριε καθηγητά, γιατί θα είμαστε εκτός τελείως χρόνια. Κυρία Ζαφυροπούλου, Μίση Ζαφυροπούλου, Γιώργη Ζαφυροπούλου, is founder of Sofa, Rifregon and Zeta Sneakers, CC Fashion Revolution Greece. It is a very big platform and thank you very much.
Ήταν να κάνετε μια πολύ ωραία φάσα. Εμείς δεν έχουμε τα... Θα αναφερθώ περισσότερο, θα σας μιλήσω για το Sofa, το μοντέλο Sofa, θα σας μιλήσω για το Fashion Revolution Greece και το Fashion Revolution το Global, το κίνημα. Και θα σας μιλήσω και για ένα από τα προϊόντα του Sofa που προσπαθεί έτσι, να εντάξει μέσα και να και elements της τεχνολογίας, αλλά να επιλύσει και κοινωνικά και περιβαλλοντικά θέματα. Πρώτα απ' όλα, αυτά που πολύ σωστά ανέφερε πριν ο κ. Καθηγητής. Το ξέρετε ότι η μόδα είναι ο δεύτερος μεγαλύτερος μολυντής του περιβάλλοντος μετά το πετρέλαιο. Συντάζομαι. Ότι είναι ο δεύτερος μεγαλύτερος σε human trafficking μετά το σεξ, με 21 εκατομμύρια ανθρώπους σε όλο τον κόσμο εκλοβισμένους σε καταδικαστική εργασία. Άρα λοιπόν, η μόδα εκτός από του glamours που έχει, επειδή ακριβώς είναι μια βιομηχανία με πάρα πολύ σύνθετο και πολύπλοκη supply chain, γραμμή αλυσίδα παραγωγής, είναι πάρα πολύ διαφανής. Και μέσα σε αυτό το obscurity κρύβονται όλα αυτά τα atrocities, τα περιβαλλοντικά και τα ανθρώπινα κοινωνικά. Οι πρόσφυγες, έτσι, είναι, από την Ελλάδα περάσανε 1 εκατομμύριο πρόσφυγες, είναι ο νούμερο ένα πληθυσμός ο οποίος θα πέσει θύμα ανθρώπινου εμπορίου, εάν δεν ενταχθεί στην εργασία. Το τρίτο πρόβλημα το οποίο αντιμετωπίζουμε σαν Ευρώπη και σαν Ελλάδα είναι το ότι η μεγάλη ύφεση, το μεγάλο πρόβλημα του κλάδου της κλωστοφαντουργίας, εδώ ο Βασίλης Ραϊκόπουλος, κλωστοφαντουργός από τη Φουτά, είναι τα πράγματα τα οποία συζητάμε και τα οποία λέει για το επίπεδο στο οποίο έχει μείνει η κλωστοφαντουργία στην Ελλάδα. Άρα λοιπόν μιλάμε για την ανάγκη να φέρουμε θέσεις εργασίας πίσω στην Ευρώπη πλέον και θέσεις εργασίας προφανώς πίσω στην Ελλάδα. Το SOFA λοιπόν είναι ένα μοντέλο το οποίο προσπάθησε να αντιμετωπίσει αυτά τα τρία προβλήματα μέσα από μια ολιστική, έτσι, συστημική προσέγγιση. Τι κάνει το SOFA? Το SOFA έχει δημιουργεί ένταξη για πρόσφυγες και για θύματα ανθρώπινης δουλείας. Αυτή τη στιγμή έχουμε δημιουργήσει παραγωγικά εργαστήρια, εκπαιδευτικά παραγωγικά εργαστήρια, μέσα στους χώρους, στα shelters που βρίσκονται οι γυναίκες και στους χώρους που βρίσκονται οι πρόσφυγες. Ξεκινήσαμε από το Λαύριο, πριν από το καλοκαίρι. Τώρα βρισκόμαστε στην Μετάδραση, που είναι μια NGO στον Ταύρο. Ξεκινάμε στην Κάριτα, στην Καλυθέα και στο AT&1, σε shelters για human trafficking, γυναίκες αδειώσεις. Και μια σειρά από 5 δομές που είμαστε έτοιμοι να ξεκινήσουμε. Εκεί λοιπόν τρέχει ένα εκπαιδευτικό πρωτόκολλο, βάσει το οποίο αυτοί οι άνθρωποι εκπαιδεύονται σε συγκεκριμένα skills πάνω στην απτική, στο πατρόν και σχεδιαστές μόδας, εάν τους ενδιαφέρει, και μετά γίνεται η ένταξή τους στην εργασία. Παράλληλα με την εκπαίδευσή τους, η εκπαίδευσή τους γίνεται σε πραγματικές παραγγελίες, τις οποίες παίρνουμε από πελάτες από το εξωτερικό, όπως είναι το Social Fabric της Ζυρίχης, όπως είναι τώρα το από την Αμερική που μας θέλουν τα headphones, το Blom. Και διάφοροι έτσι γιατί έχει ακουστεί και έρχονται συνεχώς περισσότεροι πελάτες. Οι Άνε Κρουμπέλες και διάστρια μας ζήτησε να φτιάξουμε κάτι. Η Ζήση Ενιδιών ζήτησε να κάνουμε. Και ο στόχος είναι το επόμενο στάδιο, η δομή του SOFA με τα επαγγελματικά μηχανήματα, στην οποία οι άνθρωποι αυτοί που έχουν εκπαιδευτεί μπορούν να περάσουν σε μόνιμη εργασία. Παράλληλα, σαν SOFA, από την ανάγκη μας να βρούμε, ο πληθυσμός των προσφύγων είναι ένας πληθυσμός ο οποίος έχει πολλά skills και άρα ένας πληθυσμός που μπορεί να βοηθήσει τη χώρα μας στην βιομηχανική της αναβίωση. Προσπαθώντας λοιπόν να βρούμε αυτούς τους οποίους έχουν γνώσεις στη ραπτική, αναπτύξαμε μια πλατφόρμα, κερδίσαμε το δεύτερο βραβείο στο διαγωνισμό που έκανε η Αμερικανική Πρεσβεία με το Ίδρυμα ΟΝΑΣΗ, το Hack the Camp. Εκεί πήραμε η πλατφόρμα στο refugee.com, που είναι μια πλατφόρμα που κάνει match skilled refugees με employers και unskilled refugees με training. Είναι κάτι το οποίο αναπτύσσουμε. Προφανώς η παραγωγή μας γίνεται μόνο από βιώσιμα ή ανακυκλώσιμα, χρησιμοποιούμε τη φύρα μας. Οπότε προς το παρόν ακόμα δεν έχουμε δομές για την ανακύκλωση, είναι το επόμενο κάτι θέλουμε να κάνουμε. Αλλά αυτό που κάνουμε είναι ότι επανενώνουμε τη φύρα μας, την κάνουμε ύφασμα και φτιάχνουμε τσάντες κατά τη διάρκεια των εκπαιδεύσεων. Αυτά είναι για εκπαιδευτικούς λόγους. Ψάχνουμε τσάντες όπως είναι αυτή, που είναι από κομματάκια από τη φύρα. Συγκεκριμένα αυτή είναι από ένα ύφασμα του Ραϊκόπουλου που κάναμε 7.000 τσάντες για το Ίδρυμα Νιάρχο. Ταυτοχρόνως, σαν consortium ευρωπαϊκών πανεπιστημίων, έχουμε ένα εκπαιδευτικό πρόγραμμα, το SOFA, που εκπαιδεύουμε designers. Έχουμε 172 φοιτητές από όλο τον κόσμο, από 4 ηπείρους, πώς να γίνει social and sustainable fashion entrepreneur. θα επανέλθω εδώ, γιατί είναι αυτό το οποίο το κίνημα Fashion Revolution, λοιπόν, είναι ένα κίνημα το οποίο ξεκίνησε πριν από 4 χρόνια με αφορμή το ατύχημα που έγινε στο Ράνα Πλάζα του Μπαγκλαντές, όπου κατέρευσε ένα εργοστάσιο. Ενδεχομένως να έχετε δει κάποιες από τις εικόνες τον Απρίλιο του 2013. Και όλος ο κόσμος, λοιπόν, της μόδας που γνώριζε αυτά τα atrocities, εκεί αντέδρασε και κάτω από την ομπρέλα του Παγκόσμιου Κινήματος Fashion Revolution μαζευτήκαμε ομάδες από όλες, από 95 κράτη αυτή τη στιγμή. Το Fashion Revolution Greece, το οποίο εγώ είμαι Country Coordinator, κάνει εκδηλώσεις την εβδομάδα τον Απρίλιο, αλλά κάνει και τώρα την Κυριακή, δεν ξέρω αν έχετε ενημερωθεί, και είναι και θα έχουμε και την τιμή να έχουμε την κυρία Τσάβες ομιλήτρια και το TCPL και τον Βασίλη Καρακόπουλο και Pop-Up Market. Υπάρχουν προσκλήσεις που μπορεί να πάρετε, έχει η Χριστιάνα. Στο event λοιπόν της Κυριακής, στην αγορά της Κυψέλης, του Υπογείνος Νέγρη, εκεί θα βρείτε τον κλάδο της βιώσιμης μόδας λίγο συγκεντρωμένο. Θα βρείτε Pop-Up Market από Sustainable Designers, θα βρείτε μια σειρά από workshops. Είναι όλα ανοιχτά στο κοινό, έτσι, από μια σειρά από workshops για upcycling και διάφορες τεχνικές. Θα βρείτε μια σειρά από ομιλίες. Θα έρθει η Όρσολα από το Λονδίνο, που είναι η founder του Fashion Revolution. Έρχεται από το Emmaus από το Παρίσι, σχεδιαστές. Το Emmaus είναι μια δομή ένταξης αστέγων και ειδικών ομάδων στον χώρο της μόδας. Θα βραβεύσουμε 2 σχεδιαστές που είναι και αποφοιτήσατες από το πρόγραμμά μας, της Βέντς από τη Γερμανία, η οποία φτιάχνει επανακυκλώσιμο υλικό, ένα jumper παιδικό, το οποίο γίνεται stitch από refugees στη Γερμανία. Και η Ολλανδέζα Ελή, που μεταφέρθηκε στη Ρουμανία, προσπαθεί να αναβιώσει το Ολλανδικό ρούχο και το ύφασμα από κάναβι και κάνει ένταξη σε Ρωμά. Και μετά θα ακολουθήσει party, όλη την ημέρα θα έχουμε DJ set, θα ακολουθήσει party, θα έχουμε street food, film, ένα room με ταινίες όλη την ημέρα πάνω στο sustainable fashion και 2 παγκόσμιες πρεμιέρες και την ταινία που έγινε για το sofa. Ξεχνάω κάτι άλλο, θα έχουμε recycle point, θα έχουμε το sofa bazaar για να ανταλλάξετε ρούχα σας. Νομίζω σε αυτά είναι και θα χαιρετήσει την όλη την έναρξη εκεί στις 5.30 που ξεκινάει το πάρτι και τα λοιπά, η Υπουργός Αντωνοπούλου της Κρατικής Εκπαιδευτικότητας και Εργασίας. Και καταλήγω τώρα σε ένα label το οποίο σαν σόφα να βιώνουμε. Αυτά ήταν τα Zeta Ελλάς, τα οποία σταματήσανε να παράγουν γύρω στα mid-90s. Ήταν το εθνικό industry, με πωλήσεις στα Βαλκάνια και στην Κύπρο, σαν market leader. Και ήταν και το label το οποίο έδινε την ομάδα την αθλητική, την ΑΕΚ, και είχε την ομάδα την αθλητική, την ΑΕΚ, το football club. Αυτό λοιπόν το οποίο κάνουμε εμείς είναι ότι αναβιώνουμε ακριβώς τα σχέδια που κυκλοφορούσαν 70, 80, 90, ξεκινάμε με 5 σχέδια. Η παραγωγή θα γίνει στην Ελλάδα. Το πάνω μέρος σιγά σιγά θα γίνει από τη δομή του σόφα μέσω της ένταξης των προσφύγων. Προς το παρόν θα γίνει από συνεργαζόμενους φορείς εδώ στην Ελλάδα. Τα υλικά όλα δεν είναι δέρματα, είναι sustainable υλικά, είναι microfiber. Έχουμε έτσι 2 project. Το πρώτο, το οποίο είναι σε πολύ αρχικό στάδιο, είναι η δημιουργία ενός μνήματος φυτικού από το R&D department μας, είναι η Πελαγία Κλαβεδάκη, η οποία είναι μεταδιδάκτορα σε Sustainable Textiles, και ο Γιάννης Οδρίβας, ο οποίος είναι textile engineer με μεταδιδακτορικά στο recycling. Πάμε μετά στην σόλα, την οποία σόλα θα είναι από ανακυκλώσιμο λάστιχο, και εδώ είναι που θέλουμε να εντάξουμε ένα smart technology. Απευθυνθήκαμε σε κάποιες βιομηχανίες στην Ελλάδα, δεν είχαμε τύχη. Εκεί που έχουμε τύχη και πιστεύουμε θα κάνουμε ένα outreach στο startup ecosystem, εκεί που βρισκόμαστε κι εμείς, στα incubators, για να βρούμε μια ομάδα και να μας βοηθήσει εδώ όσο αφορά σε αυτά που αναφερθήκανε πριν για τις electronic embedded νήματα. Ο Γιάννης, το μεταδιδακτορικό του, αυτό που κάνει είναι ότι φτιάξανε ένα νήμα αυτό είναι το τρίτο element που θα έχει. Φτιάξει ένα νήμα που με το κουμπί στο, στο microwave διαλύεται μέσα σε δευτερόλεπτα. Το οποίο θέλουμε να χρησιμοποιήσουμε για τη σόλα αυτή, ώστε να μπορεί να γίνεται η ανακύκλωσή της πάρα πολύ εύκολα. Το concept αυτό τον ζήτα, το κουτί είναι από ανακυκλώσιμο χαρτί, το οποίο θα γίνεται reusable και θα γίνεται λάμπα. Και η τσάντα μέσα στην οποία θα παίρνουν είναι από καμβά του φουτά εδώ, του Βασίλη Τουραϊκόπουλου. Sustainable canvas, ο οποίος ράβεται από, κατά διάρκεια των εργαστήριων που κάνουμε των εκπαιδευτικών, ώστε να συνεχίσει και να γίνεται ένα shopping bag. Οπότε προσπαθούμε όλο το concept να έχει έντονα τα στοιχεία που έχουμε σαν, και την ηθική που έχουμε σαν, σαν σόφα. Θα βγει ένα limited collection τον, το καλοκαίρι και στη συνέχεια σε μεγαλύτερο scale από, την, από το φθηνό προχειμώνα. Αυτά λοιπόν, αυτά είναι για μας, σαν fashion revolution. Περιμένουμε την Κυριακή όλους. Και τη Δευτέρα έχουμε μια κλειστή συζήτηση στο Οικονομικό Μαθήμιο, στο AC, το Incubator στην Κεφαλινίας, με αυτούς που ενδιαφέρονται να είναι μέλη και στο αύριο του, του κινήματος του Fashion Revolution Greece. Εκεί θα, θα δούμε και θα ακούσουμε την Όρσουλα και τους όλους καλεσμένους μας από το εξωτερικό. Και μετά το floor θα είναι σε όλους εμάς, να δούμε ποια θα είναι η στρατηγική μας και τα επόμενα μας βήματα, ποιοι είναι οι στόχοι μας και το μόρφωμα αυτό το, που παίρνει έτσι και με ένα νομικό σχήμα αυτή τη στιγμή. Να δούμε λίγο το structure του και, το, και την κυβέρνηση. Ευχαριστώ πολύ.
The previous two speakers, one for explaining the circular economy and how it works and giving you a whole list of ideas about how a smart garment may look, and the other one about talking about social fashion and including the ones in need in producing garments and novel products for our society. And the last two presentations in this session will be about two very interesting novel wearable devices that have been made here in Greece. So, yes, next one is.
Okay, so it's Mr. Dimitris Stordopoulos, founder and CEO of Prime Wearables Greece.
Thank you for inviting me here to speak. It is a pleasure to be here and present in front of you all. It's a very rare opportunity to have events like this in Greece, so I'm very proud to be a part of this. Thank you all for coming. As you can see, Tribe Wearables has a very unique purpose of making sportswear smart. In general, apparel and sportswear are not really smart. They have a very specific use that they do. They help you run faster, they help you not be as sweaty, they help you improve your performance. That's about it though. So, wearables, at least current wearables and fitness applications, try to help alleviate some of those problems. But here's the problem. Wrist wearables are really glorified pedometers. They count steps, they tell you that you were active, whatever that means. And they don't really know you. They don't really know what you do, what you did, what you want to achieve. They don't really understand the context of what's happening, which is normal because they have no way of understanding what's happening inside your body and what your body was doing or what was happening in the environment. So now we're moving on to the next stage of wearables, which is really smart sportswear and smart apparel, which is what the previous speakers were speaking of. So what the current smart sportswear specifically are again, like the previous speakers said, they're very bulky. I mean, it's like you're trying to run in a diver suit, but you cannot wash it. So imagine trying to run in a diver suit, but you do not, but you cannot wash it, it's horrific. And then the devices that operate those smart apparels or smart sportswear have the same size as a car's battery. it's not really a very convenient way of exercising. And then the last thing is that even the smart sportswear cannot really, don't have really the sensors, the medical grade sensors that can absolutely see inside the body and be able to understand, aha, that's what was happening. So, what is the solution to this problem? As people said before, we need sensors to be completely fused into the apparel. You cannot perceive a sensor. If you can sense the sensor, it failed, basically. You need devices that have more than a purpose of, you know, being there and trying their best to understand what the sensors are saying. And you need applications that have artificial intelligence of some kind to be able to understand you do what you want to do, reach your fitness goal faster, or, you know, get fitter, get leaner, understand what you want to do, understand what is your schedule, what have you done today, should I push you now? Are you risking injury? Should I back down? Should I tell you to back down? So all these things, the application and the device should be able to tell without you saying anything. So this is exactly what Tribus has done. We develop sensors that are imperceptibly thin. Specifically, our sensors are 0.1 millimeters thin and close to 100% stretchable and completely machine washable, which is the first in the world in anything that is wearable related. We can track motion, we can track muscle activity, heart rate, respiration even, whatever, you name it. If it is happening in the body, we can track it. Now the device analyzes the data, of course, but it also tracks what is happening to the apparel itself. So where did you run with that apparel? What did you did? What was your behavior during the use of that apparel? And then also, it provides feedback, specifically vibration feedback during the exercise to tell you, okay, you need to stop right now, you're risking injury, or you need to speed up because you're basically wasting your time, not running fast enough, or you have three more repetitions to go, or something like that. So these things is what the device is doing. And then the fitness application has an artificial intelligence coach, which actually knows what is happening inside your body and can tell you exactly, okay, you want to run today 5 kilometers at, say, 10 kilometers per hour. The application will tell you that looks a bit too hard for you today, because it knows you that usually you can do that, but today, Alan, because last night you were working on something, I slept 2 hours, and then you ate souvlaki, which was horrible for you. The application, because you have the sensors, the application knows exactly what you can do right now. It's not what you were able to do yesterday. This is what you can do right now. So it's just going to tell you, hey, you know what? This looks a bit tough. I can let you do it. And if things get, you know, a bit hairy, I will stop you. But then you can adjust to what you might be able to do better. Then there are exercise breakdowns on, okay, you did the exercise. Now what was happening during the exercise? Because we cannot really stop you mid-exercise and tell you, you know what, you're doing this during the exercise. No, you have to complete the run, you have to coach you during the run, or, you know, your exercise, your lifting, whatever you do. And then after we coach you to maximize your performance and not get injured, then after that we can basically coach you and say, this is what happened during that time. Don't worry, next time we will coach you up for that specific thing that you didn't fix during the training. And then it will be saying to you, this is where you had a higher risk of injury, this is where you were wasting too much energy, this is where your heart rate was optimal, and it will also explain what these things mean, because you're not really engineers, you are not meant to understand these things. You are also, but you were meant to understand, okay, this is what happened to me, this is how I'm able to improve it, and this is what the coaching does. And then it provides us also futures. It puts you directly in contact with people you know, how fast they run. You were, you know, the leader of that stretch of run, or you lifted the most in your group or stuff like that. And then, again, actionable feedback to improve your performance. Now, let's go to the other side. What is happening to the sportswear brands like the Nikes and the Adidas of the world? they have very few data to work with to actually understand the demographics and the segments of the market that they sell the products to. They don't really know who they sell the products and what they use and what these people use their products for. So what's up, can they really get that? Now, yes, they can get that with Drive. And the other thing is, as people said before, it is very hard to make a meaningful relationship with someone you have no connection with. So say I'm buying an apparel, that's it, I have nothing to do with Nike after that. So once is there something to connect into that apparel? To that kind of brand? Yes, now there is, because now the apparel brand can know exactly what you did with that apparel you're using, the Nike one, and they know, you know what, Vicky is running close to lakes very frequently this time of the year, or right now. So she's changing her behavior. But the apparel she's using for that run is not really meant for this, you know, for that humidity or that temperature. So next time Susie will finish her run, we will prompt her with a message of, say, 5% off for completing 5 runs in near lakes or in cold weather, saying she's a cold champion. Here's a 5% off in the new line of cold weather t-shirts. So now, say that apparel brand has a meaningful connection of knowing exactly what the user has done. And now Viking can say, wow, that's impressive. I like that and I have 5% off because I earned it. And people are 85% more likely to buy something immediately after they completed a fitness site related task. So now apparel brands can sell more. You have a more meaningful relationship with them. And also the application you're using that is from that brand, because we white label it, so that means that you are seeing their brand name and not ours. So now you have that coaching and connection to them and say, oh wow, X brand knows me so well, this is amazing, and they sell you more and more and more. And again, customer research is very expensive for them to do, we do it all for them. So the solution is, they take any apparel they want, anyone they have ready. We send them the sensors absolutely ready to be implemented into a finished apparel, so you don't have to do anything. You just take the apparel, take our sensors, press them in like a stamp. There's nothing really technologically advanced in that, and you have the smart sportswear. Just like that, the easiest thing in the world. They change nothing in the production line, they have minimum added costs, and then the resulted product has so much more functionality, coaching, fitness tracking, all that, but it has zero limitation on the original functionality, which is you can move very freely. And I will show you after that exactly what that looks like. So yes, as we said before, the benefits to the sportswear brands is offer better fitness experience, of course. They know what you do, they know what you want. Here, take it. Analytics to make better business decisions, which is, I know exactly how my demographic and how my users, how my consumers are acting, and I see the market trend. So now I can organize, say, the autumn release to match how their preferences change during the year. So now every product I make, it's a hell of a lot more likely to sell better because I'm actually designing based on the data I get. And then they can automate promotions. Say I'm designing, a biking pair of shorts. What people will like that? So they send us, they make a query to us, to our analytics. Our analytics organize automatically the events that these sale events will have the most sales, and done. They have to do nothing. As we said before, the 5% off for Vicky, that's like that. So this is what I want to straight. I'm out of time.
2 or 3 minutes.
Okay, we're close. So the market says this is what I want to straight to tell you guys more than anything else. The apparel market in general in 2016 was $1.7 trillion in 2016, right? The In comparison, the smartphone industry, which is the hottest thing in the world, in 2016, was 430 billion. Not even half, a third of the size of the apparel industry. So moving to the hottest segments of the apparel industry, which is sportswear, as you can see, all the yoga pants and the athletic tight shirts that the guys wear. So all that in 2022 is going to be $201 billion. And then the smart apparel, so the smart sportswear industry converges to that, and it's going to be almost a quarter of that. So 40 billion in 2022. So as you can see, technology is getting into the sportswear industry, not really now, we are already there. So now just exploding at 50% growth. This is insane. You tell that to an investor, my market has a 50% off growth. He's gonna, take my money. What we do is we sell hardware, sell software. We give our application basically for free. They sell it as their own. We make money off that. We offer a subscription to fitness, whatever you want to do. You want to get thinner, fitter, et cetera. The apparel brands charge you a very small fitness subscription. We take a very small part of that, and then every sale completed through our applications, we take a very small commission of that as well. The team, very quickly, me, my business partner, Nikos Angelousis, he's the vice dean of the Democritus University. This guy has done missile guidance systems, satellite guidance systems, you name it, and John is a hardware wizard. He can fit things that should go on a server to a very small device. He's amazing. Finally, Okay. If you want, you can play the video later. This is what we can do right now, running very soon CrossFit, yoga, and biking. That's about it. Thank you.
Are you crying also?
You can touch it, you can stretch it, you can hit it with a rock.
During the last presentation, please don't forget to complete, even with short notes, your feedback forms that you hopefully got when you came here. And please leave them at the registration desk before you leave, because they help us a lot in actually making some of these events more useful and better for people like you.
Θα πρέπει η ώρα είναι 7.30, 8 παρα 20 κιόλας, καλά το ρολόι μου. Έχουμε άλλη μια ομιλία και μετά πρέπει να αφήσουμε την αίθουσα. Είσαστε, δηλαδή 8 η ώρα πρέπει να μην υπάρχει κανένας μέσα στην αίθουσα. Επίσης, αυτό που θέλω να σας πω είναι ότι από τον κύριο Φώτη Παπαθανασίου είμαστε όλοι καλεσμένοι. Μετά τις 8.30, από τις 9 παρα 20, εδώ θα υπάρχει ένα ρεσιτάλ. Όμως, υπάρχει και μια δεξίωση την οποία έχουμε για εσάς, στον πρώτο όροφο. Λοιπόν, μόλις τελειώσουμε 8 η ώρα, από εδώ που θα έχουμε φύγει, ανεβαίνουμε στον πρώτο όροφο για την δεξίωση. Και 9 παρα 20, όσοι θέλουν.
Talk to you about the new category, the category of augmented mental health. It has little to do with the textile design, but it has a lot to do with wearables and how we can use sensors to change behavior. So I'm Giorgio Lefteriou, I'm the co-founder of the company that makes Feel, world's first emotion sensor and mental health advisor. And before telling you more about the product, I wanted to tell you a little bit about the problem that we achieve to help solve. So mental health is a huge issue worldwide. According to the World Health Organization, there are 450 million people suffering from mental illness every year. In the US alone, one out of five suffers from similar conditions. And this is very costly for the economy as well. If we combine the productivity losses as well as the loss for the cost for treating those issues, this costs the US economy $467 billion per year. This is many more times more than the Greek GDP. So although this is a very big issue, and nowadays we have so many technologies to track our fitness, as Dimitri said, in every medical field we have technologies and tools to monitor the progress of patients, in the field of mental health we have nothing. We have no objective data to monitor, diagnose, and evaluate the progression of the condition of the patient. That's why we developed the field. And it doesn't have to be that way, because technology tells us that there's a variety of ways to monitor mental health. And what is the key indicator for mental health? Our emotions. And over the past 20 years, in universities like MIT, the technology in the field of affective computing tells us that we can recognize how someone feels through monitoring their physiological signals. And if we combine that with cognitive behavioral therapy, then we have a mental health advisor, as we call it. So based on those principles, on those scientific principles, we developed the first smart wristband that is able to recognize and track your emotional state throughout the day and provide you through a mobile application, real-time, personalized coaching to help you achieve your inner happiness. So the wristband itself has multiple sensors that monitor the changes in your physiology that are reflections of the changes in the response of your autonomic nervous system. Probably you have noticed how you sweat when you are stressed, or how your heart is pounding faster when you're angry. All those are indicators from your autonomic nervous system that a particular emotional stimuli just happened. So our sensors monitor the changes in those indicators, and then our proprietary algorithms are using deep learning techniques to recognize patterns in those physiological changes. And based on those patterns, we can recognize if someone is happy, if they're sad, if they're angry, or if they're just stressed out. And what do we do after that? So after that, we, through a mobile application, we help the user better understand their emotional patterns, what made them feel happy, what made them feel sad or angry. So we keep track of their emotional state and we prompt the user to journal about those moments. And at the same time, we offer them personalized feedback and in real time when they need it the most. So next time you are stressed, our mobile application will tell you to do a breathing exercise. Or next time you are sad, it could tell you to write a gratitude letter or call a friend that every time that you call them, this makes you feel better. It could go up to the point that you listen to a song on Spotify, and next time that you are sad, because we saw that you were happy while listening to the song, we will play this song back to you. So personalized experiences in everything based on how you feel. Also, we'll have a human advisor as well in the process to help the user better understand their data and extract insights out of their data in order to achieve greater emotional well-being. So how are we doing so far? We have seen enthusiastic interest from consumers, people suffering from mental health issues, and people that are not suffering from mental health issues, that are just trying to feel happier. We already have a few thousand reservations. We've seen interest from major corporations in the US and a lot of press as well. Our team consists of 15 people. Our headquarters are in San Francisco, California, but we have research and development here in Greece, and the biggest part of our team is here in Greece. So our team has expertise in biomedical engineering, data science, and psychology mostly. You can meet also our marketing director, who's here with us, Olga, today. And if you want, you can visit us. Our offices are very close by in Erimu Street. So if you happen to be there anytime, feel free to hop in. So right now, where we are, we have already developed our beta prototypes. We are as we speak, we are running our first production run, and our goal is to start our beta testing early in 2018. And so if any of you is interested to participate in this beta testing, please send us an email or go to our website and complete a form. We are looking for beta testers. And it's going to be an exciting process. You're going to watch a lot of movies and it's going to be fun.
Sad or joyful movies?
I don't know. Maybe it's both. But that's only future, we want to be able to monitor mental health incidents as well, not only the emotional state of the person, but if someone is going to have a panic attack, if they're going to have a depressive episode, or even if they might attempt to commit suicide. So in the future, we envision a world where the people suffering from mental health issues are going to receive real-time support. They are going to have a psychologist in their pocket or a psychiatrist in their pocket, and every time something bad is going to happen, we're going to be able to intervene. That's what we call augmented mental health. And that was it from us. I think I made it very, very fast, right? But just wanted to give a little bit of time if you have any questions about what we do or our technology. Anything?
Thank you very much, George and the first, you saw two real products, so if you maybe they are beyond the stage of the thing of applying for wear sustain, although they may come with some pilots and so on. But all of you talk to them because you will learn a lot of valuable experience how to develop a real product in this segment, and what is the road and what you need to learn. This is a great opportunity where sustain talk also to the other mentors and to the other people who are here, to the speakers who cover today some very important societal and also economical issues and so on. Talk to the Greek hubs and please do form teams. If you have great ideas, please apply for where sustain funding and support, because it's a great and unique opportunity. And we would love to see many projects and many teams from Greece apply. I think it's a good moment to do this. So thank you for coming. And there will be a networking session later on. But we don't want to.
Thank you very much myself. Thanks, Stavri, because you open us a lot of perspectives. I was really thrilled listening to all of you. Some I knew, but some were really new to me. And I'm very happy that you've all been here. Thank you so much. And we go on working together. Don't hesitate to come and look for us. Here are my cards. And then now we can all meet. You can please take a card if you need them. And then we will meet, all of us, at the first floor for the reception. And now we have, I believe, to leave the room. Thank you so much.
While you're leaving, what's playing is some of the selected projects from the first open call, but as I said, you can find information about them on the website. So thank you once again. Thanks for coming.